getting the blinker. As presiding and chief officer of the Senate, one of your major responsibilities will be the assignment of committee posts to various senators. The passage or defeat of legislation is often dependent upon the complexion of these committees. If elected, before making committee appointments, would you consult with labor representatives regarding the makeup of committees that will handle labor measures?
I have, and always have before, as you well know. Wouldn't think about doing it until we did.
Is there legislation you are interested in securing or preventing passage not covered by this question act?
I can't think of any. If you all have any others, though, I'll be glad to try to answer them.
All right, we'll turn back here now. Let's see, I believe it was number three and number five,
I believe, are the two we skipped over.
I think we read them earlier.
Yeah.
You want to just...
I would like to see the benefits raised above the $35 maximum. Now, Tom, as I've said to you many times before, I know very little about workman's compensation. I know very little about this Unemployment Security Act because neither my law practice has not carried me into it on either side to any great extent. In fact, I've never tried a workman's compensation case. I will make this statement that in all of the battles before the legislature when I was up here, I think you know that I took a great deal of my counsel and talked again and again and again to those of you who were familiar with it and tried to go along with the views of labor in a good Workman's Compensation Act, and I think you know too that we were successful in killing again and again many of the damning amendments or features, some of which have later been adopted during this present administration. Now, I think I know from my past conversations with you people who really studied this thing and knew it, that on the extension of the maximum period beyond 450 weeks, that there was some discussion at the time as to what that would do to the insurance rates and whether or not it was wise to extend this amount or try to get the maximum weekly thing as high as possible. My theory on this workman's compensation is I want to see the working man, and I may be talking about my client, as a matter of fact, because I represent no corporations or no industries. But I want to see the man get just as much as he can get out of it without breaking the thing down. And I think the emphasis should be to gradually and to steadily try to increase the amount of the benefits, both in time and in dollars and cents on a weekly basis. And I definitely work toward that. Now, on this proposition of extending it to the widow until remarriage, I'm just frankly not... I'm not competent to answer that question. Again, I get back to say that I would like to see the man and both his widow get just as much as possible, and I would not do anything to... I would not be a party to any legislation, let me say that, that would deny the working man just as many benefits or as much monetary compensation as could possibly be awarded him. I mean, I don't think you all want to cripple industry in the state, and I've never so found. I definitely think the worker ought to have freedom of choice on his doctor.
You see, one reason we are concerned with this particular facet of this thing, Governor, is that I know when we interviewed the candidates for governor, two or three weeks ago, yeah, I think they asked Claude the question when we came to this.
Yeah.
Well, don't they have freedom of choice? Well, no, they actually don't. They're supposed to go to the company doctor to begin with. Then, of course, they are at liberty to then go to their own doctor if they're not satisfied. Then
that
worker is put in the position of being in the crossfire.
That's right. That's right.
Of the medical ideas on this thing. One says this and another says something else. So actually, it creates confusion there,
yeah.
And the worker suffers as a result.
Defensive.
That's right.
Well, ultimately, when you go before the court, it's who can write most testimony.
That's right.
That's about what it amounts to.
I have a case right now where a boy lost part of a hand. The company doctor determined the percentage, one percentage. He wasn't satisfied with it. He went to another doctor and had it determined. He determined 10% above what the company doctor did. Now the insurance company or the insurance service wants to settle that claim for the in-between.
It could very well be just the reversal. If the company wasn't satisfied with your personal doctor, then let him be on the defensive rather than the worker.
Mm-hmm.
After all, it's the worker that's being hurt. He's the man that sustained the injury.
Of course, we use E here primarily because as a result of these crippling amendments of 1960,
yeah.
It's almost got to where that people just don't get it without going to court.
That's right. That's right. I'm going to say this. When you say crippling amendments, of course, one man may say, well, what is your definition of crippling amendments and what were all the amendments? I know that some of those amendments of 1960 ought to be repealed, and I certainly support those. And I would say this, that I am open, and I think you all know me well enough, and I think I'm close enough to you all to say that when your representatives come up there and sit down with me on this legislation to accomplish for the working man of this state a good end, that I'm going to go along with you on it.
Great deal
for an
accountant through administration.
That's right. That's right.
All but one of the 60 amendments have been, for practical purposes, eliminated through court.
Decision.
Decision.
Mm-hmm.
But now we've come up with a real crippling decision. I don't know how committee you are with that.
No, what is that, recently?
Yeah.
What was that? What was the nature of it?
Heretofore, the courts have always held that the monetary benefits drawn during the temporary total disability period is not accountable in the final settlement.
Mm-hmm.
Well, might as well call the name. Bob Everett wrote a decision contrary to that. And, of course, all carriers have applied. If I'm temporarily totally disabled for a period of 12 months, $35 a week is counted against my final settlement once a determination is made.
Mm-hmm.
That can touch it drastically in the settlement. In other words, that applies to $14,500 maximum on all benefits, monetary benefits.
And of course, that is the present administration's idea of labor's representative on the commission.
Yeah,
is doing this.
That's right.
This is real rough.
Well, I'll say this, and of course, this is not in the prerogative of the lieutenant governor, but I think that a great disservice was done to workman's compensation law the workman's compensation commission, when they just finally decided they were not going to honor that original division,
right?
One for public, one for industry, and one for labor.
Right. Any other comments on workman compensation? Okay, I believe we read this one a few minutes ago. And of course,
number five.
Yeah. If elected, would you favor the following improvements? Raise the benefits above maximum $30. Extend maximum period duration beyond 26 weeks. Allow workers to qualify who are thrown out of work because of labor dispute after plant is back in operation. Remove unfair disqualification provisions of the present law.
Well, there again, certainly I'd like to see the, I mean, let's just face it, $30 a week is not much money. It's like $35 a week is not much money on the thing. How much more you could safely go, I'm not an expert enough to say, but I'd certainly, my whole tendency is yes. My whole feelings are sure we need to increase it. And I would certainly work toward accomplishing that. At the same time, there may be, from your standpoint even, there may be some reasons in there why you say to increase it very much is to do detriment to the whole program. If so, then I think what we'd have to do is sit down and work out what was a fair increase on it, and I would be completely agreeable to doing that. The same thing is true on the 26 weeks, and I want to say this, I'm against anybody's proposal that a man who is out of work and drawing it can be drafted in to go out here and do some kind of work that might keep him busy during that time, to work on the street, so to speak.
chop cotton or pick cotton.
That's right.
Yeah, well, that's
a lot. You opposed some remarks that I heard this recently. He can find dishes to wash, cotton to chop.
That's right.
And he's the barn.
Regardless of what their skill may
be. That's right. I'm definitely opposed to that. I mean, I think this thing is a matter of accomplishment for the dignity of man, and he ought not have to get out on the street and sell apples before he even qualify for it. Allow workers to qualify who are thrown out of work because of labor dispute after plant is back in operation. Now, Tom, just what do you mean by that?
Well, actually, now, you see, they're disqualified if a person is out of work who is involved in a strike.
Yeah.
And of course, as it is now, even after it's over, they're still disqualified. But what we are saying here is this, that they should be able to qualify after everything is over and back in operation,
mm-hmm.
not while the strike is actively going on.
Well, I think there's great merit in it.
Well, of course, that's assuming that he's not put back to work, that he's still...
Yeah, that's true. Well, that's after the operation is going on, but this particular person or persons is unemployed.
Yeah. I think it's great merit in that. And I'd certainly be in favor of removing any unfair disqualification provisions.
Yeah, this is something that we've been quite concerned about for some time. You know, they use the word misconduct in the text of this law.
Yeah.
And the employer has taken the word misconduct and just stretched it all out of reasonable bounds.
Mm-hmm.
A person, as I think he used a good illustration this morning, we'll take the garment industry. You've got maybe 10 or 15% of the total number of employees who are making their quota. You know, garment industry is all set up on piecework. Well, all of a sudden they start a wholesale discharge of those people because they're not making their quota.
Yeah.
Well, when the company notifies the Employment Security Commission that these people have been discharged, their reason, see, they have to give a reason, they say misconduct.
Yeah.
Well,
they're the judge of what misconduct
that's
is.
That's right. I mean, according to the way the law is written, this word misconduct can just be used in any manner.
Yeah.
Well,
gentlemen, let me say this. Y'all got any other questions to ask then about this thing?
No, I think this is...
As y'all know better than perhaps anybody else, this proposition of labor, management and labor, both relations and law, is a thing that has become a very, very... detail field. And it's a very, very technical field of the law now. And it's a field, frankly, that unless a person applies a good bit of time to it and keeps up with it from day to day, both the decisions and the laws, you just don't fully understand it. And I will very frankly confess I'm one who has not kept up with it. I've been out of office now. I tried to when I was over here from a state basis. But I've been out of office 4 years now, and I have not followed it as closely as I did. In addition to that, I was just one of these fellows sort of vaccinated with the law, and it didn't take too much. I just don't do a whole lot of law practice, and I represent no big companies, and we just sort of live from hand to mouth in the practice of law, and so from that standpoint, I have not been in it a great deal. But I think that one of the biggest things that you've got to face, I know in the Mississippi legislature, there are those that if you simply say that this will help labor, they're against it. Or if you say this is going to hurt industry without any study of the thing, they jump up and say, well, we got to be against it. But most of the boys, both in the legislature and most public officials, I think, want to be fair about the deal. And their basic interest is in seeing that the Mississippi worker makes progress and enjoys more prosperity and has a fair break from both a contractual standpoint and from the standpoint of the public protected. And I think, Tom, and I've thought this a long time, and I think you and I probably have talked some about it just in personal conversation, private conversation, if there was some way to get over to the average average member of the legislature that comes over here, both on the matter of this unemployment security proposition, on this matter of workman's compensation, where and how it really helps the man in his county, I think a lot of them that have never gone along would be more interested in going along. They get a sort of a distorted idea, don't you think?
Well, yes, that's true. That's true.
And I know it's a big job to do it. I know that you've got a lot of obstacles in the way of doing it. But I know again and again and again, bills have come up there that I thought, well, this thing's got a lot of merit to it. And then some of your people would come up there and sit down with me and with other members of the Senate, leaders in the Senate, and point out the thing and say, well, we can't have this at all. It won't do at all. And see that it was shelved, died in committee, and those kind of things. And I want, if I'm elected, I want you all to feel, as far as I'm concerned, I want you to feel free, any of you individually or as a committee or as an interest. And I think you know you have been able to do it and will continue to be able to do it. Just come to my office, and it's always open. And sit down there with me, and we'll call in those who have this particular bill in charge, and we'll just go over it from A to Z on the thing and point out the defects and the weaknesses and the inequities in the thing. And then I'm willing to go along to try to see that there is an improved condition all over the state of Mississippi on these matters.
I might say this with respect to what you just said, that certainly it's true that we do need to make contact with more members of the legislature, House and Senate alike,
yeah,
and to attempt to enlighten them as to what our aims and objectives are and remind them that they have people, that their constituents.
That's right.
Are some of the people we are talking about.
That's
and
right.
This certainly we have done. We're doing a little
You're doing more
we
all
intend
the time.
To
That's
do
right.
more in the future.
That's right.
As Dean Farley says, we're not looking for an unfair advantage.
That's
right. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I believe that. I found that out.
What we want is just a fair share.
That's right.
Now, we don't want
That's
somebody
right.
in our hip pocket. Neither do we want
That's
a public
right.
official elected in the hip pocket of the MEC or the MMA.
That's exactly right.
We want somebody
That's
who's
exactly
fair
right.
and impartial at all times
That's
with
right.
all people. Do you have any statements you'd like to make and before we get into the specific subjects here?
I might say that what I'm
doing is running for lieutenant governor, and I'm going to lay my cards on the table with you fellas this afternoon. I'm going to be as honest with you as I possibly can be. I might not agree with everything that that you are working for and would like to see enacted and take place in the state of Mississippi. But before I could be of any service to you at all practical purposes, I first got to be elected lieutenant governor. And the man who out in the state of Mississippi gets the most votes is going to be elected. Now, I might, in discussing these different things, I might have an opinion, which will be my personal opinion, wherein I would not advocate out in public. I would advocate on the stump due to the fact that, as I said, because of all practical purposes, I won't be elected lieutenant governor. I am sympathetic with labor. I'm sympathetic with the working class of people. But as I go down these questions and attempt to answer them, some maybe I'll need to think about before even attempting to answer them. I want every vote that I can possibly get, but I have some convictions and some opinions, and there's some things that I couldn't do and you know I couldn't do. So I think that for you to know that I'm going to be as honest as I possibly can be with you and lay my cards on the table with you as we discuss these different issues. Because well, I want a better Mississippi. I want the economic condition of our state elevated in any way possible. I think we're down, what, about 50th in the
state
of the
union.
We'll get
a new state, we'll be 51.
And I think it's a shame and a disgrace. I really do. I think it's a shame and disgrace. I am a Mississippian from birth. I love the state. I'm proud I'm a Mississippian, but there are some things about it I'm not proud of, and that's one of them.
Right. Well, I might say this to begin with, that certainly we know that as a matter of human nature, that you and I, you and he, or anybody else, not going to agree on everything. We're not looking for a person, a candidate or a public official who is a yes man to organize labor by no stretch of the imagination. And I might say that this no candidate that we have talked to or will talk to have seen this any earlier than you have. Nobody, they all come in, this is new to them, so you're on an even basis with all the rest of them. All right, sir. Mississippi is the only state in the Union that does not have a Department of Labor or a similar department to function as such. As a result of this void, the welfare of wage earners is being sadly neglected. In addition to this neglect, no appropriate state agency exists to mediate labor disputes or furnish vital information necessary to an industrial society. If elected, would you lend the support of your office to the creation of such a department?
At this present time, I would not. Due to the fact that I believe that any such organization in the state of Mississippi at this present time, a word that we'll be using quite a bit, is not feasible and not practical. Because, you see, if such a department was set up in the state of Mississippi, I am of the opinion that the manufacturers would control it. I think that we do need some organization set up where in advisory capacity, such as one maybe located in Mississippi State. But I don't believe that that a department at this time in Mississippi would be controlled or meet the need that labor needs met. due to the fact that, as I said, I believe that it would be controlled by the manufacturers.
In other words, I take it by your remarks that you do recognize the fact that a State Department of Labor as such, if properly organized, if the law, the bill was properly drafted, that the department would strictly be a department of serving employees, employers alike,
right.
and would
right.
not be a tool of organized labor. You know, this seems
right.
to be the
right.
the opinion in a number of areas in Mississippi. This seems to be the basis of objection here, that this, a Department of Labor, would be the tool of organized labor, that its functions, its services would go would not go beyond the limits of organized labor, which is not true.
True,
you know?
That's right.
It's to serve all the people and would be a help and an advantage to employers as well as employees. A true State Department
yes,
of Labor
yes,
would.
Yes, that's right. That's true.
Here is one of our reasons for concern about things. You may have seen that. But that's one of our reasons for advocating such a department. It's in this area that a Department of Labor would be particularly beneficial to people of Mississippi. See, actually, there's no law, frankly. The only way of administration, or the only thing that you can refer to handle a matter like this, is simply a policy adopted by the State Health Department. Not a law by any means.
To make them do it.
Right. There's no way to force this. The State Department of Health has adopted, years ago, I suppose, more or less a policy and procedure that they would inspect these places. For the full state of Mississippi, I understand there's one inspector and one assistant.
And I've never even seen them.
That's true. And I mean, this is something that we are concerned
yeah.
about. See, not only in the union shops.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as far as the union plants are concerned, in a number of instances, we in negotiations between the union and the employer, we seek to get in every little agreement that we can about certain health and safety conditions in the plant. But think about the thousands of unorganized workers, see? This is the people that we are thinking about here, actually, see? That there's no guarantee of any regulations or anything of this type. Well, the Department of Labor, certainly one of its main duties would be to administer laws and regulations of this type, which
yeah.
there's nobody to do this.
That's right.
So that's just a little illustration of our
what
interest
the need
in
is.
Thing.
Yeah.
That's right. That's
right.
Minor, of course. If you really knew a lot of other things, conditions similar to this that now exist, it
be
would
magnified.
Really be a, that's right.
Be
alarming to know
yeah.
The conditions that really exist in this state as far as health and safety regulations are concerned.
Okay.
We don't have it.
A lot of places, environments under which the workers are working, paint spray booths and everything.
Right.
I don't guess they have any rules and regulations or laws making the employer adequately ventilate and provide respirators and so forth.
This is more needed since we have more of the metal industry that is coming into this section or into the state. For a while, we only had the needle industry, and then we began to get the others, and now the metal industry. Of course, this is referring to Lee County, and which is where I'm from.
Mm-hmm.
And I know some of the conditions there. Of course, the plant that I represent is organized, and we have some safety regulations within it. But my wife happens to work for an insurance agency which covers a number of the policies within the other, and it's alarming at the accidents that occur within these other plants where they don't have the safety regulation.
Tupelo is an industrializing area too, rapidly, isn't it?
Yes.
Just one other passing comment on that too. As I stated to one of the other people that we talked to this morning, at the present time, the record shows that we have engaged in non-farm occupations 436,700 people. Now, farmers have had a Department of Agriculture for years and years. We're rapidly moving from an agricultural economy to an industrial economy.
Aye.
With no organization that would cater or to protect
or to go along
regulate
with it, yeah,
with that enormous number of people. And Mississippi happens to be the remaining one state in the 50 that doesn't have a Department of Labor. So we think just to be, we're not saying we ought to have it because they do, but we're saying we ought to have it because
of the
need.
Right. Dire necessity.
Another way, we
think
people
are
important.
Yeah.
More so.
Yeah. Yes. And their lives, health problems.
Any other question by the committee? Comment? All right. In spite of the fact the Mississippi legislature was recently reapportioned, our lawmaking body is still not representative of the taxpaying public. What is your position on this subject?
Attempt was made in the reapportionment by the state legislature to apportion representation, I think, in the state legislature by the population. I don't know whether or not they did a good job of it. I haven't had a chance to study it. I do not think that it was the idea of the men who embodied the law on reapportionments. I don't know whether they even took in consideration that they were attempting to represent the taxpaying public. I think it was thought that it would be reapportioned as to the population. I would have to agree that it does not represent the taxpaying public. It brings up the question of the voice in your government: is it the population, or is it the man who pays the taxes, the public taxes. Of course, we all feel that if we bear the burden of of the tax of our state, that we ought to have more voice in the government. It's a natural thing for us to feel that way. But I believe that those who authored the reapportionment bill didn't take in consideration, tried to reapportion the representation of the state of Mississippi as to the taxpaying public more or less on population.
Any questions, any comments? Mark, John? Mississippi was the last state in the nation to adopt a workman's compensation law. Since its adoption in 1949, little has been done to improve the lot of the injured worker. To the contrary, the act was practically emasculated by crippling amendments in 1960. If elected, would you favor the following improvements to this act? A. Raise weekly benefits above the present $35 maximum. B. Extend maximum period beyond 450 weeks. C. Extend benefits to widow until remarriage. D. Allow freedom of choice of doctor. E. Make employer or insurance carrier liable for attorney fees when worker has to resort to courts for relief. F. Repeal the crippling amendments of 1960.
Talk along the workman's compensation, you inadvertently ask some questions or specifically say something about it because of the fact that I think, first of all, before you can obtain A, B, C, and D, and E, you've got to dispose of F. I think that before you are able to get those, you're going to have to dispose of F. I'm for the working man. I think that, as I said in the outset, that we're 50th in the income in our state, and I definitely and certainly think that the wages of a working man should be raised. I'm in agreement that we need to raise his pay, and therefore we'll raise the economy and give him better living conditions, and then when he has better living conditions acquired through the money that he makes through his work, then he's going to do a better job. Now the benefits that come from workman's compensation are too low because of the fact that I believe that workman's compensation is figured on a certain percent of the employer's total pay, isn't it? Payroll.
Per
$100. I thought that it was figured on $100 of his.
Any questions?
Could I say something? Would I be in here and take the salary that the people get today and
plants in Mississippi. If that salary was increased, wouldn't that help compensation?
Sure.
Workman's compensation. It would, it would.
Yeah. I mean, anytime it's based on $100 payroll, this is what we're confronted with now. They holler a higher rate on workman's comp. Of course, various trades carry greater risk, therefore, it's fluctuating cost per $100 of payroll. In other words, a lineman out here exposed to high voltage, certainly risk is greater than a clerk in the store. So the sad part about it is, if it takes two people to total $100 a week payroll, then you've got two risks to the same exposure.
Right.
That one person, the one risk would be if the one person
that's
low wages, high rate as far as work.
That's what I meant with the economical condition of the state of Mississippi, is that here in Mississippi it takes a man who has a factory out here, and he has 100 employers in that factory. Say he has 100 employers in that factory, and they earn a certain given specific amount. Ours is so low that 10 in New York would earn the same amount of money that the 100 are earning here in Mississippi. And I think that thing needs to be brought up on a level to where for the same job done in New York, I think the person in Mississippi should receive the same amount of money. And then when you raise those, then the benefits automatically will raise, won't they?
Any other comment? Okay, the future progress and welfare of our state may well depend upon the education of our youth. Unfortunately, Mississippi has a lower percentage of high school graduates attending college than any other state in the Union, without doubt. This deplorable situation can be attributed to the lack of finances. If elected, would you favor legislation whereby the state would guarantee loans for college education to qualified high school graduates?
I was in Borlin, Mississippi, day before yesterday, visiting a tool and engineering company. Some of you might be acquainted with that company. Moved in from St. Louis. Makes parts for missiles. Makes parts for different government contracts. I was talking to the owner of the plant, and he said, the trouble with Mississippi is that you have plenty of labor, but you don't have the right type of labor. He said, I could use several men, but in order for me to get those men, I have to go back north to get them. He said, the greatest need of your state is to educate young people into fields wherein they would be able to supply the labor for these plants that are coming in here. He said, I have transported or have to transport or bring into Mississippi certain personnel that I use in my plant because I can't get it available here. There's plenty of work to be done if I could just get the kind of labor to do it. Whether or not I would support the state guaranteeing a loan for college education to qualified high school graduate, at this time I don't know whether I would support it or not. However, I do say that there's a great need for someone to guarantee or to give to these qualified high school graduates a loan whereby they could go to college.
question? The purpose of unemployment insurance is to provide benefits sufficient for workers to maintain a reasonable minimum standard of living when unemployed. Mississippi Employment Security Act leaves much to be desired in this direction. If elected, would you favor the following improvements? A, raise maximum weekly benefits above $30. B, extend maximum period of duration beyond 26 weeks. C, allow workers to qualify who are thrown out of work because of labor dispute after plant is back in operation. D, remove unfair disqualification provisions of present law.
Value of a dollar is so deplenished and and so depleted that $30 a week is not enough for a man to even buy bread for his family. I certainly think that that the maximum weekly benefit should be above $30. And beyond the period of 26 weeks on certain cases and in certain cases, determining the nature of the employee who is disabled. Every man has a right to by his own merits elevate himself in any category in which he finds himself, and certainly a qualified worker who is thrown out of work because of a labor dispute should, after the plant is reopened and reorganized, should have the opportunity to qualify as a worker in that plant on his own merits. If I'm not familiar with the disqualification provisions of the present law enough to discuss it.
Basically, what we are concerned with here is in the text of this law, as it's now written, they use the word misconduct. And the employers have, over the last several years, very carelessly used the word misconduct. Now, I'll give you an example that was used with one of the previous candidates we talked to here of a situation of this kind. We'll take the garment industry. As you may know or may not know, the garment plant is set up on an incentive basis, on a piecework basis. You do so much work to make so many hours. Well, we'll take a situation to where you've got about 15 or 20% of the total employment of the whole plant that are actually making that set quota. You know what I mean? Well, this has been going on for some time, and all of a sudden, the employer decides to clean house, see, and go to discharging these people. Well, then they are supposed to give the Employment Security Office a reason for the discharge of this person, the reason that this person no longer is employed. Well, on this slip, we'll say this person was discharged because of misconduct. Now, I don't think, or it don't seem to me, that the fact that the person is just unable, you know, some people are more skilled, they are more inclined for certain things, speed particularly, which accounts for a lot of the ability to make these quotas in this type industry. They just don't have it. Well, I don't think you could construe that as being misconduct. Well, now, this is a situation we are concerned with because it confronts
does
us
exist
day after day. This word misconduct in the law, and they certainly take advantage. And this is why we put this D in here.
Well, I think in the light of that, Thomas, that that there should be a group from management and from personnel of the plant, a representative group, to sit down and decide what actually what has been done by the employee, and ascertain whether or not it falls under the category.
Well, actually, under the setup, you see, Employment Security Commission, when a person, here's the situation roughly and briefly, when a person has been discharged under the similar circumstances where the reason is given as misconduct, they go to the Employment Security Office, they sign up, make application for unemployment. Well, this goes on for several weeks. And then what will happen, they will be told that this has been denied, and then they'll put misconduct for, because you were discharged as a result of misconduct on the job. Now, this person can appeal this decision of the commission. And it takes quite a period of time for the person known as a referee to hear this case. Then, if I err, one of y'all correct me, then, after the referee has heard this case, if the person still thinks that they hadn't been dealt with justly, then they can appeal again to the, not the advisory committee, but what is it? It's the appeals committee. Again, it's a common advisory capacity to the commission itself.
Let me ask you a question. What's happening to his financial condition during the process of this?
That's
off,
it.
Living off of his neighbors.
There you
well,
are.
I'm
you
not,
see.
I'm not, this, I'm not,
you see,
I'm
this
not
is the actually the only way they can go about, the only
I
procedure
that, some,
that they have at
I
their disposal.
I believe that some provision, what that provision would be, I don't right now know. But I think some provision ought to be made for that individual during the time of this. Everything at his home still goes on. The lights
That's
are
true.
Still on.
That's
the telephone
right.
still
right.
To be paid. And I think that some provision ought to be made for that man during. Well, that thing could run out in no telling how long.
Well, it does involve quite a period of time.
This is actually what has happened. 6 to 10 weeks to process a case at your office.
What's
now
the
what happens? You go and register for your unemployment insurance, or actually turn that wrong. Register for employment. If they can't furnish it, then you're subject to your insurance. 3 or 4 weeks will pass before you actually know that it's questioned. Then 2 more weeks, you are informed that it is questioned. You got 6 weeks insurance there. It's such a technical field of law over the misconduct question until the normal layman couldn't handle it on his own.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now you got to hire a lawyer.
Yeah.
If the lawyer sees fit to take the case, any cost, it would be 50% of your unemployment insurance. So who's going to question it? You wouldn't have anything left when you got to process it anyway. Therefore, the employer is gaining everything and the employee is losing it.
Therefore, allowing him to use that weapon more
facetiously.
And it's certain that the use of it is widespread.
I could cite your plant, it's not too far.
Yeah.
And this is not in the immediate area of the water valley. But it's going, and it's going like wildfire through a plant. And as far as I know, first employee has been discharged for misconduct, like a little bit of meat quarters, which about 10% of the plant does meet. And they have made the first unemployment insurance yet in one of the discharge cases. So.
That's a situation.
The community should be concerned with it more than us.
Yeah.
Because
grossmen don't get paid. The light man doesn't get paid. Rent doesn't get paid.
Wouldn't the whole thing stem around the definition of this misconduct?
The word.
Right.
Be a coverall in whichever.
That's right.
Thing could be sheltered under, but to, as you would in a contract or in a any law, that certain definitions be given to what constitutes misconduct.
An amendment to this act defined in more specific terms.
That's right.
The word misconduct.
Include in or exclude out. What is meant by that, and not using it as a coverall.
If a lady was working in a garment factory and she didn't get her quota, they have a training period, I believe, mm-hmm. to get up to a certain place and they can't get their quota. If they need them, don't they let them go ahead and work and pay them on what they do get? I mean,
In most cases you find it this way.
But now, just like you said, I'm sure that all the ladies in Water Valley don't get their daily quotas. I mean, it's, some of them is impossible, the way they sound. So many duds.
Well, you find this too. When they do meet the quota consistently, they slip a new machine in the shop and raise the quota. And they set that impossibility again. Now, I can name you people, or name you one particular person that I'm acquainted with that was a satisfactory employee for 3.5 years. Attendance is near perfect as you'll find, especially in that particular type of industry. She's one of the victims now.
Misconduct.
Goes large. Period.
Just this other one thought, and then we'll pass on to something else if you want to. This is used too, this technique, where you have a organizational campaign going on in a not open shop plant. And it is generally known that it gets known, comes to the ears of certain supervisory personnel, which represents the employer, that such and so has signed a card or he's talking union. But now, through maybe just a trumped up charge, or maybe he's made that mistake a dozen times over a period of 3 or 4 years, but suddenly that gets to be important. And he's discharged, and he's, when he goes to apply for his unemployment, misconduct.
Probably the best man in the plant, the best man, be one of the best.
So you can see it can be used a number of ways.
It could be.
And it is done.
Well, it needs to be redefined as to what the word.
There's another advantage too. After you pass through a training period, the minimum wage becomes just in most of them because it's interstate commerce products. The merchandise or product produced by trainees goes into production as long as it passes inspection, just like everybody else. Trainees are exempt. So when you get a group of old people in there, and this happens, I know, move on east, and I can fight you some more cases. When you get too many people that's out of the training period, you can always get rid of them and keep those trainees down there. 6 bits an hour, where right now,
they keep moving like that, lay down pressure on them.
Coming and going. Sacrifice a little bit on production.
plan to another.
Mississippi's tax structure leaves much to be desired. Most of the state's revenue is derived from the sales tax or other consumer taxes, which means that the bulk of the tax burden is being carried by those least able to pay it. According to reliable estimates, the state will need $40 to $50 million in new revenue to balance its 64-66 budget. Assuming that you're in favor of a balanced budget, how would you propose to raise this needed revenue? We'll stop right there. That's not all of that particular one, but we'll stop right there for the time.
There was a $64,000 question. This would be.
This is
one of the questions that many politicians have promised a utopia and various and sundry ways in doing it, and it has not been obtained or acquired. It's a question that you can't take in $50 a week and spend $51 and never expect to balance a budget. And there's no person on earth that's able to do that and has done it, spent more than come in, except the United States government, and I don't know how they do that. But they have done it over the past years. I am in favor of a balanced budget, and I think that there's some process by which we could balance the budget, and let's get back to the place of, well, why raise the revenue to meet a budget that we've moved out so high that we're unable to raise it unless we come right back to the man who pays the taxes. We have to come back to that point, to the man who pays the taxes. In other words, we are assuming here that we've got to balance the budget and we've got to raise added revenue to balance that budget. But I think sometimes that we need to let our budget ride along with the income from revenue of the state of Mississippi. I think that we have been too easy going on the fact that we outdistance our budget. This would take a long time to study and to talk about and to seek out ways to raise the added revenue.
Okay, we'll go ahead down to the A, B, C, D, E, F, and G of that. What is your position in regard to the following items? Revision of state income tax laws whereby the wealth and corporation would carry more of the tax burden. B, further increase in the general sales tax. C, increase in severance tax. D, legislation requiring uniform assessment of real estate tax. E, closing present tax loopholes on finance companies, cattle, timber, utilities, and etc. F, taxing so-called cooperatives who are in competition with legitimate enterprises. G, removal of sales tax from food, clothing, and medicine.
There's a tax in the state of Mississippi. I'm going to answer this, all of these with this explanation. There are companies in the state of Mississippi who pay a tax known as a franchise tax, operational tax, and then at the end of the year, their income tax, they figure out the income tax, and then they're able to take this tax and deduct it from their income tax. And I think that that's a loophole that certainly a lot of money is getting out of the hands of the state government, and I think that that loophole should be filled. That gap should be brought together. There are some people who cannot do that, and others who can. The companies who can, and I think it's a need that we do need to take the present loopholes that we have in that type of tax and place it back on the ones that it should be rightfully upon.
Let me ask you this one direct question with reference to this group here, particularly on B. Would you favor an increase in the general sales tax?
No, sir. Wait a minute. Wait just a second. Let me.
That's only 4% are we paying right now?
Mm-hmm. You mean on? Yeah. You mean on the 4% sales tax that we're paying right now? Let me say this. With our added population in the state of Mississippi, definitely and certainly we've got to have new roads. We need roads in Mississippi worse than. Most of our neighboring states, new highways are needed, and they are needed now. We're far behind on our highway construction. There's schools that are going to need money, and I'm in favor of certainly getting some additional revenue or some additional taxation from some place to meet these needs, but. At the present time, I'm not for increasing the sales tax.
Any questions from the committee?
I would just ask if he would express, cares to express any opinion on the possibility of tax co-ops. They're in direct competition with
industries. I think that would be one of the avenues of which I would investigate. Definitely and certainly, they're in direct competition with the man down the street, and they're able through. Their ability not to pay certain taxes, they're able to lower their product and sell under this man who's made a living in this town all of his life. And that thing ought to be equalized.
People that I work for and with are utility people. If I might come in for you, we also have a Watkins group manual. We've been particularly concerned over the fight between public and private power here within the state. The case that went on, expansion of city limit case, which no doubt you're familiar with. As a result of the court decision on that, giving the co-op a right to not only stay, but to operate within the corporate limits of a city after the city limits expand out and bring in their revenue areas. The door is wide open. They put themselves in a position of direct competition with the taxpaying industry. If they're going to be competitive with them, then certainly what's good for the industry. Again, as we've seen, see it. I realize, too, that that's a strong political group within many states, not just this state. But you've got your oil mills. The fertilizer industry is loaded with co-ops, as you very well know now.
Well, they've not only covered the field of fertilizer and things that the farmer needs. they're now in the service station business. They've branched out into the insurance business. And I enjoy. Let me say this: I enjoy, and of course, every fellow around here wants to get as much as he can for his dollar spent. I enjoy living under TVA. I enjoy the low rate.
Here.
But
my story just a little further. This is the late habit. Down in Pensacola, Florida, at one of the, what's the air base for Pensacola?
Naval Air Base.
It's a Naval Air Base. Well, they have recently put in a new tracking station down there. And it's a pretty good load as far as the current is concerned. I think we've reached about 10 kW, about 10,000 kW. Now, when this tracking station equipment, tracking equipment was bid on, service was also bid on to serve current for that. Gulf Power Company was serving at the present time. The co-op that serves all around the area came in and submitted a bid on. And they underbid the existing private utility by the tax structure. 24%. Exactly what portion of the revenue collected by the private industry paid by taxes, paid into taxes. Now, they carried it to court, and the first decision of the court granted it to the co-op by virtue of their low bid. Now, that puts the company in this position. Do we have to sell that co-op current to deliver to the base or give them permission to build a generation station? You know, that's a real big argument now, Mobile Plant Family or something. But that's some of the things involved.
If they had been taxed the same, they'd have to have been on the same taxation. They would have had to submit the same bid, because the man that's already there could have furnished them. Without a co-op, he'd come in cheaper, 24%.
You know, this is probably not even in this. I looked at the rest of the questions. But you know, I wonder how you feel about one thing I think that needs to be done in Mississippi, and I believe it has been done in one or two areas, but do you ever buy a piece of masonite from the masonite plant over at Laurel, or you didn't buy it from there, but it was produced there? In any building supply in the state of Mississippi, wherever you buy it, and that thing shows it was manufactured in Chicago. I think that the state of Mississippi should at least have on that product where it was made, that it was made in the state of Mississippi. You know, pet milk and carnation milk never carried the name of Mississippi product, Wisconsin product, always, until recently I picked up a can of pet milk and saw that it had, along with some other states, Mississippi. Instead of just saying Wisconsin, it had the name of several states. I'm proud enough of Mississippi that I want Big Yank up there at Water Valley to have made in Mississippi.
I think it serves a real purpose, not to for the manufacturing. Again, I'm not criticizing industry. They're essential to the economy. We all recognize that. Again, we want a fair shake out of it. Many times it's manufactured here by dollar an hour labor.
Yeah.
In competition with maybe an eastern industry, a northern industry, at $2.50 labor. Shipped to a central warehouse, and all goes out as one product, and the retailer, I mean the consumer, pays the retailer exactly the same thing, regardless of what the cost of manufacturing
is.
Well, that's exactly the reason that a lot of plants are moving in to get this cheap labor.
Yeah. So this is a dumping ground for that kind of industry.
And that's one of the reasons I say we definitely have a need that products made in Mississippi should care in Mississippi.
Any other questions on this subject? During recent years, a number of construction projects financed by local or state funds have been manned with out-of-state workmen. Many of these projects were financed with bond issues supported by local citizenry who thought workers from within the state would benefit by new jobs provided. The only effective means to deal with a problem of this kind is to enact a state prevailing wage law. If elected, would you support such a law?
I said to begin with, it'd be my personal opinion that that would be the only way in which you would be able to deal with a problem such as this in the state of Mississippi. I think it would be very unpopular at this time due to the fact that it runs into an interstate question. But again, we get back to where we were a while ago. I'm not too familiar with what your wage law would entail to duly express or to answer that question, as maybe it needs to be gone into.
I might by way of explanation here, just a little more detail of what we're actually talking about. This would particularly benefit the non-union workers. Of course, as you know by the nature of this or the way we stated here, that it's on your building construction job. Now, in the organized in the union, we have agreements, our people, one local with the other, even out of state this way, where if a union contractor that works union labor gets a job, by then certainly he would pay, regardless of who he worked on the job, he would pay the prevailing wage in the area. At the same time, if a contractor who does not work union labor, an out-of-state man gets a job, 9 times out of 10 he will bring people from out of the state, you see, and he will not pay the prevailing wage in the state or in the area, the union wage, in other words, what it amounts to. He brings out-of-state people in while our people walk the streets. He works these people for substandard wages.
Mm-hmm.
down in my hometown of Hattiesburg, the new city water works down there. A non-union contractor got the job, and as a result of no law of this kind that we speak about here, then he came in with out-of-state people and built that project with substandard wages. And as I said, your union contractors, they have an agreement, you see, where these things are worked out. But again, after you get beyond the bounds of organized labor, certainly these people have no recourse. And if you don't have a state prevailing wage law, see, this would, this as you noticed here in the first sentence, first and second sentence, we point out it's financed by local or state fund. Well, you have the Bacon, Davis-Bacon prevailing wage law, which is your federal law. See, if there's federal money, well, then that applies. But in the situation that we refer to now, where there's no federal money involved, well, then certainly the federal law does not apply. So actually, they come in and they pay people for just ever what they want to pay them. And only a, as we point out here, only a state prevailing wage law would eliminate this problem.
That does deal with state funds.
Right, state and local funds. There's no federal funds involved in this particular situation we're talking about. As I said, if there's federal funds, then the federal law would apply, see. But here again, you're out of reach of the federal law. Definitely a local situation.
As it exists in the state now, if it's not in the state of commerce, construction money, not even the $1.15 an hour.
Right.
Wide open, whatever you can get. The least that you can get. Now, we had several hundred thousand dollars involved in street extension down here. Under Faster Railroad, I see. A contractor from Louisiana came in. Of course, that was a city project. Came in and out of several months' work, two electricians. Local electrician. He got 3 days' work on the entire project. The rest of it was Louisiana people. Well, who knows what they got? Wait. It was a non-union contract. If it had been a union contract, they would have at least worked local people and paid the negotiated scale for the job. So, right as it stands now, if it's not federal funds, actually, there's no control in the state of Mississippi as to what wages will be paid. With bond issues or whatever source of money might
be. Of course, as I said to begin with, the primary purpose is to get elected. First of all, because I wouldn't be of any value to you at all unless I was in the office, and if I personally, even though maybe sympathetically, I would be for it. If I would be supported openly, then I would be very unpopular wage law at this time in the state of Mississippi.
Any question? How form of government can best be protected by greater participation of the electorate? Many states have secured better participation by changing election days to Saturdays. Several states have also enacted laws whereby employers must allow time off to vote. What is your position on this matter?
I don't feel like that we should change election day till Saturday, but I think every person has a right to vote. Only can you have a democracy when the people vote and voice their opinion, whatever ways needs to be worked out so that that man can vote. I think everybody in America ought to vote and have the right to vote.
Just a little explanation here as to why we pose this as we do. In most of the union plants and union jobs, we have an agreement, some cases in writing in the contract, other cases of a verbal agreement, that those employees who cannot get to their precinct after their regular work hours then will be allowed time off to go vote on election day. And of course, as I say, this is taken care of where the union is. But the people we are concerned with are those working people, mostly in this particular instance, that have no union. They have no bargaining power, you might say, with the employer. Now, the reason we injected Saturday into this as a usual thing in Mississippi, Saturday is not a work day. And this is the reason that we have used Saturday here. The election day has been changed in one or two other states, as we point out, from Tuesday to Saturday, which has increased participation to some extent.
Well, then
but it's these people that we are concerned with that have no bargaining power, you know, with reference to time off to go vote during a work day.
Well, then I still ascertain it first, primarily, every person should have some way, some time, a chance to vote, because that's the only way we could ever remain free, and that's why we're selling our freedoms by the installment plans today, because people just fail to vote and to use their influence in casting their vote. I don't know that I would have too much against voting on Saturday. I think primarily, as I said, first of all, I think that everybody ought to have the right to vote and should vote. If it took coming to that place that we'd have to vote on Saturday to allow people to vote, I still, first of all, say that everybody ought to vote.
Tuesday, if I might say this, is just about the worst thing that you can have. People have just spent a weekend at home. They've maybe driven 100, 200. You'd be surprised if people make a living away from home. Miles getting back to the job on Monday, turn right around and have to drive equally as much or twice as much. Lose a day on Tuesday. Get back to the job and wins. Our people, when I say our people, the construction that we work with, are scattered all over the country. It would have to be on Saturday. In many cases, for it not to cost them 3 days' wages plus two-way travel, many times 500 miles one way. For example, Illinois, Florida.
So he just goes ahead and works and is thereby disfranchised.
Actually, he can't afford to vote.
That's right.
You know, economically can't afford to vote. He's qualified, he's eligible to vote. Could vote if it was on Saturday. But economically can't afford to vote. That applies to a lot of savings, too.
One of the greatest attributes we have as a free country is the right to vote. And when that's gone, then anything can happen.
Now, the present setup with this absentee ballot, being in that position, cannot vote anyway.
Right.
Got to be a transportation.
Any other comment or question? One of the major needs of Mississippi workers is protection against loss of wages incurred by non-occupational injury or illness. The prohibitive high cost of medical and hospital care makes this a most serious problem. Workman's compensation insurance recognizes the need of insurance for workmen on the job. It would therefore appear that a temporary disability insurance law is the answer to this problem. Would you support legislation of this nature?
Who's to pay the cost of this temporary disability insurance? Would it be the workman? Would it be his employer?
Yeah, you had
of course, we as employees prefer that it be the employer, because he's got a method of passing it on. The employee has no method of passing it on, which, you know, again, would be additional cost of production. We recognize that. But just last week, we was in negotiations with the employer that we work with on an insured income plan on a 50-50 share premium basis. So any arrangement could be worked out between the employer and the employee. This, you find in many instances, and I think more so in the unorganized industry than you do your organized industry, because they can get several benefits by it. But if they feel that wages are substandard, they would pay the entire cost. The entire premium would be a tax concession, and they in turn could get tax concessions for employees' benefits. Actually, you know, in a pretty good volume of business would be getting $1 worth of insurance for the employees at 48 cents cost for the employer. So many employers will bear the burden for that reason. What we're negotiating is 50-50.
Let me ask you just one question. If I was a lineman and came into the lot here on the truck, I got off the truck, checked out 5 o'clock, went down the street, stepped off down here and broke my leg, which took my job away from me at that time. That's what that covers, off the job.
Off
I mean, that's
it. Non-occupational.
Workman's comp.
That's what
job.
I mean. Off the job, does not cover you off the job.
But the insured income plan will cover you off the job.
And I mean, working compensation does not.
That's right.
But and that's what you're trying to get off the job.
Off the job and extended illness. Actually, if you want to elaborate just a little, and this is relatively new. In our contract, we would set out based on seniority. The number of weeks of a person's payroll would not be affected based on seniority or time with the company. It would be a minimum of 2 weeks, and then an additional week for every year year spent with the company. His payroll would not be affected, irregardless, on the job, off the job, injury. Now, when that time was expired, then you would go on to your insured income plan at 60% of your average monthly or weekly wages. With your tax concessions, it would be your average about 70% of your pay. You won't get 100% coverage. You couldn't expect anybody to be sure with 100% because you have malingerers since you're dealing with people. So,
yeah.
So it's really something that could mean a whole lot for you.
You can't pick your place where you get hurt. I mean, you don't expect to get hurt, but
more people get sick and lose time from off the job or from normal sickness than do from job injuries. Yet you insure the job injuries and neglect the real needed aid. Don't care how you get sick, that's when you need money.
And shower. You pay a doctor so much a day for every day you're well. The day you become sick, the doctor's pay stops until he gets you well again. And when he gets you well, he's I've traveled all over the world. I find a lot of places that people are not so backwards as we think they are.
We have this coverage within the plan that I represent that is totally paid by the company. It not only covers the worker, but it covers the dependents of the worker.
But if this law is passed, though, that would force the employer to pay full off the job insurance. Is that correct?
Depends on the length of the law. If it was stated as work comp is, yeah. It could force him to carry it or provide it on whatever basis agreed. Just like, as I understand it, or as I would suggest, the employer of workman's comp does not have to have an insurance company at this time. It can be self-insured. I think it could be proposed with the gate open for condition between the employer and the employee. That would be my opinion.
Well, and my answer to the question would have to be that I'd have to first see the law, the temporary disability insurance laws. As you explained it, if it brings the employer and employee to an agreement and a meeting, that
any other comment?
I wish I knew more, and you'll think after I finished this afternoon. I studied law. In the wide fields of all the problems of Mississippians, labor, and everything else, a man cannot be an expert on every area of the activities that he is placed as a public officer. I don't call myself an expert on labor or its functions or its unions. When I take a thing and analyze it and study it, and when it comes to the place where there's got to be something done about it, then at that time, I'll sit down and study that thing and come to an unbiased, honest opinion, which would be what would be best for the individual. course, a lot of these questions, I might, if I had an opportunity to take these questions and study them and study the background of them, I might answer them differently.
Top flight school teachers are absolutely necessary if our children are to receive the best in education. We have no right to expect skilled and dedicated teachers to remain in our schools unless we are willing to pay them a living wage. In spite of the fact that our teachers receive some recognition by the last legislature, their salaries are still far below the average paid by most of the southern states. They are pitifully low compared to the national average. Are you in favor of increasing teachers' pay to the average for southern states?
It's a shame that in the state of Mississippi and other states that we pay garbage collectors more than we do our teachers. We say that the garbage are let's take it like this, we pay unskilled laborers digging ditches and so forth. We say that must be done, but we forget that a child's mind must be trained. And it's a shame that the teachers who take the young generation and have the responsibility of teaching and training future Mississippians, it's a shame that we pay teachers such a wage that you can get out and do something else and bring in more, bring in a larger check. Something's got to be worked out about the teachers' salaries in the state of Mississippi. We're going to have to, because we're losing teachers to other states. They're going to the place where they can secure the highest wage, and something must be done with the teachers of the state of Mississippi.
The setup to have on this present teacher, we lose the best teachers to other states.
Right.
People that cannot qualify, we got them teaching our children.
One thing we talked to this morning said they were just talking to teachers, leaving good school systems in the state of Mississippi. Going to Birmingham for 1,300 years.
I tell you where this reflects more than any one place. You go to our colleges in the state of Mississippi, or our college anywhere, you can almost pick out a child from what school they came, high school. You can watch them. You can tell what a Valians, you can put them in college without any identification tag on them, and you can watch their process in college and tell if they basically got it in school, in high school. And it's a situation that needs correct.
The labor laws of Mississippi fail to provide adequate protection for children employed in interstate commerce. In view of the fact that Mississippi's economy is moving from agrarian to industrial, it is imperative that our child labor laws be updated. Are you in favor of improving these laws?
Child labor has always been a touchy situation, and I agree that children need the adequate protection. And there's quite a bit of improvement that needs to be done with child or children employment in the state of Mississippi.
A state employee has a right to job security as does any other worker, provided he or she is competent and efficiently fulfills job requirements. Stability and efficiency of our government demands that legislation be enacted whereby a person would not have to guess right in a governor's election to retain employment. To discharge a state employee to create a vacancy to be filled by a supporter of the winner is morally wrong and costly to the taxpayer. Are you in favor of a civil service law to cover all state employees except those who are elected or appointed under specific requirements of law?
That's true. I'm in favor of the most efficient and the most competent person to hold a position in the state government that we can get. Whoever that person supported, whoever that person supported as their opinion is the best qualified individual to fill the public office. They should not be deprived of the right to hold the job if they are the most efficient person that that can be obtained. If sometimes we are loyal to those who are our friends and who elect us to these offices, and if an adequate, competent person who's a friend of ours, we are prone to want them in the position. But certainly I believe that the most competent and efficient person that we can find. Your highway patrol in the state of Mississippi is hurt tremendously by not having the highway patrol under some civil service laws to govern the highway patrol, and I'd certainly be for a full investigation of it, and it's
any questions? Mississippi is one of three remaining states in the nation that still refuses to allow women to sit on juries. This prohibition is unworthy of the enlightened people of our state. The House of Representatives passed a women jury bill during 1962 session of the legislature, only to see it die in committee when it got to the Senate. What is your position on this matter?
A woman has a right to vote. She has a right to sit on a jury. I'm sure Evelyn Gandy answered it that way. And I agree with that. I think that we should allow women to sit on the jury. In the state of Mississippi, they are citizens of the state of Mississippi, and I think that they should be allowed the right to sit on juries in the state of Mississippi.
I've called this to the attention of the other candidates today, a little humor. 4 years ago in this room, we were talking with a candidate for governor, and of course this question was posed at him, and he says, well, I'll tell you right now, he says, I'm opposed to these women being locked up in these jury rooms with these men.
I never think about that, but at least in this area, I'm a rebel and a segregationist, so this should apply here.
I think the women would take care of themselves.
Well, of course, naturally, we had in mind that there would have to be certain accommodations
provided. One of the candidates for governor that we interviewed, that he was in favor of that because he felt like that would be a means of improving the courthouse facilities,
yeah,
to say the least.
That's right.
One hard thing to get done, as you well know.
This is true. It's true that the last legislature increased maximum assistance to the aged and totally disabled from $40 to $50. It's also true that the same legislature failed to appropriate the necessary finances for this assistance. This failure means that few of these people are receiving over $40 per month at the present time. If elected, what do you propose to do about this situation?
Once again, we come back to another question that was asked earlier about the budget of the state of Mississippi. The legislature that increased the maximum assistance of the aged in the state of Mississippi did a wonderful job. Failure to appropriate the money and to find the funds is just as bad as not doing it at all. I think we ought to come back and start over and find where we can support the increase per month for the aged, and certainly increase the total disability to $50.
In a democracy, the supreme power to govern is retained by the people. Mississippi's Constitution agrees with this concept, for Article 3, Section 5 reads as follows: all political power is vested in and derived from the people. All government originates with the people, is founded upon their will only, and is instituted solely for the good of the whole. Unfortunately, the will of the majority is often circumvented in Mississippi because the legislature is not representative of a majority of the people. Our neighboring state of Arkansas has an initiative referendum procedure whereby the people can exercise control when the need arises. Would you favor a constitutional amendment providing for such a procedure in Mississippi?
Certainly, I agree that all political power is invested and derives from the people. That's a sad part of the situation which exists in the nation today. The majority are not allowed to control or to rule. As to how this unfortunate situation would be corrected in the state of Mississippi, I think that there should be a lot of study made on it, and whatever it would take to provide that the people did control the government, the majority of the people, whatever was needed to see that was done, it certainly needs to be done. Because that's just exactly what's happened on the national level. The majority of the people no longer rule.
The per capita income in Mississippi is the lowest of any state in the nation. The chief contributing factor to this dilemma is the low wages paid to workers who are not covered by the Fair Labor Standards Act. 27 states have already enacted state minimum wage law. Such a law would do much to raise a per capita income and increase the purchasing power of the state's workforce. Are you in favor of a state minimum wage law? Excuse me.
I don't think that at the present time it would be the time to pass such a law, even though I believe that the per capita income of the people of Mississippi is low figure. I don't believe that the general consensus of the public and its opinion would go along with a minimum wage law.
Any questions? A lower percentage of people of voting age are qualified voters in Mississippi than any other state. According to figures recently released by the American Heritage Foundation, only 25% are qualified. Without doubt, the chief deterrent here is the restrictive poll tax laws. This tax must be paid 2 years in succession to be eligible to vote in the Democratic primary. While it may be argued that the poll tax keeps a Negro from voting, the record shows otherwise. When this law was enacted, 1890, there were 120,000 white voters. 2 years later, this figure had dropped to 68,000. Due to the rapid industrial development, many people are moving into our state. Due to these poll tax restrictions, these people are being disenfranchised for a 2 year period. So such restrictions are certainly not conducive to industrial development. If elected, would you attempt to alleviate this situation? Specifically, would you advocate an amendment to the Constitution whereby 2 years poll tax could be paid at one time?
I'm not for abolishing the poll tax in Mississippi. It's a way of revenue, of course.
Sure.
Actually, like you said, I think the primary function of it was to keep the Negro from voting. I think that's what it has brought in its income. But you get involved too here with a question that I think everybody ought to have the right to vote, and that everybody ought to vote. Whether this would answer the the situation or not, I don't know. In paying those poll tax 2 years, what do you mean? When I go up there today, as say February the 1st, I can pay this year and next year, or pay this year and last year?
This year and last year. In other words, fix it so you could pay, if you were delinquent 2 years, fix it so you could pay both years at one time in order to vote. As it is now, of course, you know, you have to pay it during that month of January or prior to February the 1st each year, 2 years in succession, in order to be able to vote. We recognize the fact that the money derived from the poll tax is certainly useful, but at the same time, we are of the opinion that the manner in which you have to pay it here makes it hard on people who have moved in to become qualified to vote. That's how simple it is. We're not saying they shouldn't pay it, but that they should be able to pick up the year behind and be able to vote the next time.
But you do mean that this person is a legal a voter in other respects, such as residency and so forth.
Yeah, sure.
I don't, at this present time, I don't see any reason why I would object to that. I can't think of any right now.
Is that just pertaining to people that come into the state, or is that if I just don't pay mine, if I don't pay mine?
Well, anybody.
Well,
of course, we refer to people to the industrial development. That's true, but if you've forgotten it, or if you might have been working out of state or something the previous year during the specified time, you see, well then you could come in and pay that and you'd be eligible to vote, see, like it is now, you cannot. If you missed last January, you dismissed it.
I had a lot of experience with that. Missing one. Cost a lot of money too.
That sheriff is supposed to take those books, cut those things right off there at the end of the first day of March.
Yeah, but his knife wasn't sharp first day of March.
Some of them's knives got a terrible gout.
That's a lot.
Women constitute approximately a third of the state's workforce. In spite of the fact that these women are usually better educated than men, they earn a third less. In many cases, women can be found working side by side with men, doing identically the same work, yet being paid much less. Many states have corrected this inequity by enacting laws requiring equal pay to women for work equal to that done by men. Would you favor legislation of this kind?
Was it only a few days ago they...
Yeah, there's Congress has passed legislation. But there again, you see, this only affects people in certain categories. This legislation would pick up where the federal law leaves off, you see. Because you've got thousands and thousands of people beyond the reach of the federal legislation, you see.
Of course, my answer to that is twofold. First of all, and this is just personal, is that I think all the women need be back at home. You know, in the state of Mississippi, we don't have enough jobs for the men. Somehow, but I do think that women ought to receive the same pay for doing the same job that a man does. However, answer is that on the other hand, that I'm selfish for the fact that, as it was stated here, that these women are out distancing the men and their work. But I do think that. Women who do the same job ought to be paid the same amount of money. But I still think they ought to be back home.
In other words, number one, they ought not to be out there,
that's
but if
right.
they're there then doing
that's
the
right.
same work, then they should
that's
be paid
right.
us. Okay, I think we got it. During the last year, the regular session of the legislature lasted for a period of 5 months. Approximately 3 months were also spent in special sessions. In addition to being costly to the taxpayers, many members of the legislature have indicated they have suffered terrific financial loss and can no longer afford the luxury of serving in our lawmaking body. It seems that annual sessions of the legislature with a definite time limit would alleviate this situation. Are you in favor of annual sessions limited to a definite time period?
If it takes that to get the kind and type men that we need in legislature. The legislature, the state of Mississippi, is one of the most important functioning bodies in relationship to the economy of the state and every other way. And here we are, we have John Doe, who is not qualified, and this man who is qualified cannot leave his business because of the terrific financial loss that he has in serving in this legislature. We need to do something whereby the best men in the state of Mississippi can serve in the legislature of our state.
We have men that are now in the legislature who are not seeking re-election simply because of the hardships they suffered last year.
And then all of that experience that they've had, see, is just wasted, just thrown away.
As presiding and chief officer of the Senate, one of your major responsibilities will be the assignment of committee posts to the various senators. The passage or defeat of legislation is often dependent upon the completion of these committees. If elected before making committee appointments, would you consult with the labor representative regarding the makeup of committees that will handle labor measures?
If these men, I would want labor to hand me a group of unqualified men to serve in this on this committee, but if labor were to give me a group of qualified men, of which I'm sure that you would want, I'd go along with the consulting you on the appointment of these men, provided you don't appoint one of my ardent enemy.
Political opponent.
One of my ardent political enemies, but so far as consulting with you and the appointment of this these committees, I'd go along with you. But I wouldn't want just anybody. I'd want you to pick men that could really do the job.
Well, again, I'll make this statement that we don't want a lieutenant governor, a senator, or anybody else as a hip pocket too.
Yeah.
We want somebody that'll be fair.
Yeah. Well, that's
and impartial.
What I was had reference to, but I didn't.
Is that legislation you're interested in securing or preventing passage of not covered by this by this questionnaire? In other words,
not at the present time.
Well, Mr. McKay, I'll say this on behalf of the people here that we appreciate your time. Coming by and talking with them.
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed meeting with you. As I said when I first started, that I was going to be as honest with you as I knew how. Not that I knew.
Any statement you'd like to make, anything before?
First, I want to thank you for allowing me to appear before you. And any questions you have, in addition to the ones on here, you just fire them away and you'll get a point-blank answer.
Okay. we will begin here with at the top. Mississippi is the only state in the Union that does not have a Department of Labor, a similar department to function as such. As a result of this void, the welfare wage earners is being sadly neglected. In addition to this neglect, no appropriate state agency exists to mediate labor disputes or furnish vital information necessary to an industrial society. If elected, would you lend the support of your office to the creation of such a department?
I'd like to answer that by a positive statement that it's a disgrace to our working people in this state that we don't have, and absolutely I would support a Department of Labor.
In spite of the fact that Mississippi legislature was recently reapportioned, our lawmaking body is still not representative of the taxpaying public. What is your position on this subject?
Well, I would say there's been an improvement made. I don't know who and what portion of the state is not being represented. But if there is a section that's not properly represented, then certainly there should be some consideration made. But I do know that there was a step made in the right direction during the reapportionment law.
Just a minute, Tom. You are informed that the press has been invited to.
That's true. I'm glad you mentioned this, Dr.
What
press
I say,
had been invited.
What I say is open and public, and the press can use it, or anybody else that wants to.
There is, of course, a number of things, as you know, always going on in the Capitol, and some of these boys are on vacation. They've got substitutes, and of course, they're not as familiar with the situations as the regulars. Therefore, they haven't been around. The thing's been open to come in. Yeah, we knew you all didn't have anything to hide. We don't.
I don't have anything to hide, and I tell you, I would tell everybody this
one,
state.
One of the boys walked in and stayed a little while. We hadn't seen him. Thank you for calling my attention to that, Jack. I'd forgotten it. Mississippi was the last state in the nation to adopt a workman's compensation law. Since its adoption in 1949, little has been done to improve the lot of the injured worker. To the contrary, the act was practically emasculated by crippling amendments in 1960. Would you favor the following improvements to this act? A, raise weekly benefits above the present $35 maximum. B, extend maximum payment beyond 450 weeks. C, extend benefits to widow until remarriage. D, allow worker freedom of choice of doctor. E, make employer or insurance carrier liable for attorney fees when worker has to resort to courts for relief. F, repeal the crippling amendments of 1960.
Well, in regards to the workman's compensation law, I'd like to say this. That law was formulated in my office in 1948 over a chicken dinner. Lawyer G from Rolling Fork, who was then in the legislature, and some other representatives on that committee came to my office. We had dinner at my home. At that time, my home and office was adjoining. So we had a big chicken dinner. We sat down and we patterned that law after the Virginia law. We didn't make the best law in the world. We did the best we could. Those fellows did. They consulted me on certain things. I was part of it. But we thought as time went along, the law could be improved to adjust to the situation at hand. But instead of being improved, the law has practically been destroyed. And the working people are limited more so than before. Now, question A, raise weekly benefits above the present maximum 35. Following along question three there, part one of part A, raise weekly benefits above the present $35 maximum. It's no way in the world that a man can hardly even pay his necessities on $35 a week. Now bear in mind that when a man is injured, he's injured and doing the job, on the job, if he's covered by workman's compensation, is something of not of his doing. And certainly the man may take a decrease in his salary. And if he's accustomed to making $100 a week, then he may have to take a decrease of 25%, 35%. But it should be a flat fee here, just wanting limit of $35, I wouldn't go for that. I would increase it according to what the man's salary was. On some people that do day labor, their living conditions, maybe $35 would be a pretty good maximum on that. Have got accustomed to living in circumstances that even their salaries possibly could be increased. I would favor extending the maximum period beyond 450 weeks. That should be double at least. Extend benefits to widows until remarried. There is a question there in my mind on that subject. And if I answered that I would extend it, it'd have to be qualified. That, again, would depend upon the individual case. So I'd have to qualify that for the benefit. It's possible that if a man was killed on the job, his widow certainly should receive some type of compensation until she's remarried. There's an insurance program that may enter into that picture too, so there's many ramifications on that. Allow workers freedom of choice of doctor, absolutely, without a question of a doubt there. Make employer insurance care liable for attorney fee when worker has to resort to court for relief. That is a necessity and should have been enacted a long time ago. Repeal the crippling amendments of 1960 without a doubt. I would repeal, at least I would put it back where it was and try to increase the benefits instead of taking away. Future progress and welfare of our state may well depend upon the education of our youth. And I'm reading this question, and Mr. Knight, maybe you should, if you want to.
Go ahead.
Unfortunately, Mississippi has a lower percentage of high school graduates attending college than any other state in the union. Without doubt, this deplorable situation can be attributed to the lack of finances. If elected, would you favor legislation whereby the state would guarantee loans for college education to qualified high school graduates? I would. I'll let you answer the other questions as I ask me the questions.
The purpose of unemployment insurance is to provide benefits sufficient for workers to maintain a reasonable minimum standard of living. When unemployed, the Mississippi Employment Security Act leaves much to be desired in this direction. Elected, would you favor the following improvements? A, raise maximum weekly benefits above $30. B, extend maximum period of duration beyond 26 weeks. C, allow workers to qualify who are thrown out of work because of labor dispute after plant is back in operation. D, remove unfair disqualification provisions of present law.
I would favor A, raising the benefits above $30 a week. Extending maximum benefits beyond 26 weeks, I would favor that. Allow worker to qualify who are thrown out of work because of labor dispute after plant is back in operation, absolutely. That was no fault of his own. Remove unfair qualification provisions of present law, absolutely.
Mississippi's tax structure leaves much to be desired. Most of the state's revenue is derived from the sales tax or other consumer taxes, which means that the bulk of the tax burden is being carried by those least able to pay. According to reliable estimates, the state will need $40 to $50 million in new revenue to balance its 64-66 budget. Assuming that you are in favor of a balanced budget, how would you propose to raise this needed revenue?
Well, one of the first things I would do is try to put a halt to some of the corruption that we've got going on in the state of Mississippi. Some of these officials that's got their hands stuck out behind them would be have that hand clipped off right quick. I would legalize whiskey. I think that it's disgraced the way it's being handled. It's legalized on I would favor a county option plan. Without a doubt, I would legalize whiskey. And I feel that it's a disgrace to have one law saying it's legal and another one. It makes us the laughing stock of the nation. Okay, that would be two of the things that I would do.
What is your position regarding the following items? A, revision of state income tax laws, whereby the wealthy and corporations would carry more of the tax burden. B, further increase in general sales tax. C, increase in severance tax. D, legislation requiring uniform assessment of real estate. E, closing present tax loopholes on finance companies, cattle, timber, utilities, and etc. F, taxing so-called cooperatives who are in competition with legitimate enterprises. G, removal of sales tax from food, clothing, and medicine.
A, the answer to A, revision of state income tax whereby the wealthy corporations would carry more of the tax burden. I feel that the wealthy corporations should carry more of the tax burden. Further increase in the general sales tax, I feel that any increase would place additional burdens on the man that's already paying most of the taxes. I wouldn't favor that. Increase in severance taxes. Possibly would want to study that a little more. I don't know what the severance taxes are presently, and consequently I don't know what I would like to put some study on that topic. I'm not too familiar with the severance taxes. I'm sure that applies to all fields, and I'm just not brought up on that topic. Legislation requiring uniform assessments of real estate. Absolutely, I'd favor that. Closing present tax loopholes of finance companies, cattle, timber, utilities. Absolutely, I'd favor that. taxing so-called cooperatives who are in competition with legitimate enterprise. I'm not too familiar with what the tax structure is with the cooperatives. I know they do pay some tax in some form, but I'm not too familiar with that topic, so I don't want to, I would qualify my answer there that I just don't know exactly what I do with the co-ops. I know that there's some tax, and I know it's a lot of misleading information passed on to a lot of people, and so consequently I'm not going to answer that. Removal of sales tax from food, clothes, and medicine. Food, clothes, and medicine are things that are absolutely necessary. And if any sales tax is to be removed, frankly, I believe all sales tax should be removed, but if the first sales tax is removed, certainly should come off of those things that people have to have in order to live.
During recent years, the number of construction projects financed by local and state funds have been manned with out-of-state workmen. Many of these projects were financed with bond issues supported by local citizenry who thought workers from within the state would benefit by new jobs provided. The only effective means to deal with a problem of this kind is to enact a state prevailing wage law. If elected, would you support such a law?
Yes, I would.
Our form of government can best be protected by greater participation of the electorate. Many states have secured better participation by changing election days to Saturdays. Several states have also enacted laws whereby employers must allow time off to vote. What is your position on this matter?
I believe that on election days, we should certainly allow time off to vote. And if a study could be made and proven that more people would vote on Saturday, then they should be allowed to have the election should be held on Saturday.
You see, the reason we mention this, Doc, for the group of people we are concerned with on this particular thing is those unorganized. The organized people either have it in their contract or the local has a mutual mm-hmm. understanding with the employer that mm-hmm. these people have time off to vote. But the unorganized worker, as is the case, his case and everything, he's at the discretion of the employer here, see. And of course, without a law, election being on Tuesdays, a lot of these people are not able to vote.
Mm-hmm.
All right. One of the major needs of Mississippi workers is protection against the loss of wages incurred a non-occupational injury or illness. The prohibitive high cost of medical and hospital care makes this a most serious problem. Workman's compensation insurance recognizes the need for workmen on the job. It would appear, therefore, that a temporary disability insurance law is the answer to this problem. Would you support legislation of this nature?
I would support legislation of this nature, anything that would improve upon the insurance for disability, temporary disability insurance.
Top flight school teachers are absolutely necessary if our children are to receive the best in education. We have no right to expect skilled and dedicated teachers to remain in our schools unless we're willing to pay them a living wage. In spite of the fact our teachers receive some recognition by the last legislature, their salaries are still far below the average paid by most southern states. They are pitifully low compared to the national average. Are you in favor of increasing teachers' pay up to the average for southern states?
First, let me say that whoever prepared this statement had given it a little bit more thought. There's a lot of people employed by the schools other than teachers. Now, we know our teachers are important, and I certainly would favor increasing the teachers' salaries to that of those other southern states or above it, if possible. And I would also like to add this. I think that we should not have to force our people to retire that are teaching school. On certain instances, they should retire. other instances, they may be capable of working longer. And I do believe that there should be a 20-year optional retirement program for the school teacher. And of course, if they taught longer, then they would, their retirement benefits would be a little more, would be increased accordingly. So I would favor that. I'd also like to say this on that topic of school teachers. You have a lot of lunchroom managers in this state, and those people feed our children every day. And they need some consideration. Some of them are working for $125 a month. And others, that's in Jackson. Now, I don't want to say that's in Jackson. I know that's in certain areas. Even in other areas, they don't make but $60, $70, $80 a month. They may be feeding 400 or 500 children. The lunchroom managers and workers in that lunchroom, it's important that we have top flight people preparing our food to serve to the people, to our children throughout the state. So I wish that this too had been included in your question, because not only does the school teacher's salary need improving, but also the other workers in the schools.
The labor laws of Mississippi fail to provide adequate protection for the children employed in interstate commerce. In view of the fact that Mississippi's economy is moving from agrarian to industrial, it is imperative that our child labor laws be updated. Are you in favor of improving these laws?
100%.
A state employee has a right to job security, as does any other worker, provided he or she is competent and efficiently fulfills job requirements. Stability and efficiency of our government demands that legislation be enacted whereby a person would not have to guess right in a governor's election to retain employment. To discharge a state employee to create a vacancy to be filled by a supporter of the winner is morally wrong and costly to the taxpayer. Are you in favor of a civil service law to cover all state employees except those who are elected or appointed under specific requirements of law?
Absolutely.
Mississippi is one of the three remaining states in the nation that still refuses to allow women to sit on juries. This prohibition is unworthy of the enlightened people of our state. The House of Representatives passed a women jury bill during the 1962 session of the legislature, only to see it die in committee when it got to the Senate. What is your position on this matter?
First, if we could get it passed again by the House, and if I was presiding over the Senate, I'll assure you that it wouldn't die in committee, because I would place it into a favorable committee. I have supported that for a number of years. I think it's, is a disgrace to the intelligence of the women of this state.
It's true that the last legislature increased maximum assistance to the aged and totally disabled from $40 to $50. It's also true that the same legislature failed to appropriate the necessary finances for this assistance. This failure means that few of these people are receiving over $40 per month at the present time. If elected, what do you propose to do about this situation?
I would propose a study that would not only provide the funds, but we go further than that. There are more needed than just the funds. There is certain supervision of the aged that is needed in our state. There are certain recreational programs that could be provided. There are certain group centers that need to be erected to provide our aged citizens with a wholesome atmosphere that they deserve.
In a democracy, the supreme power to govern is retained by the people. Mississippi's Constitution agrees with this concept, for Article 3, Section 5 reads as follows: all political power is vested in and derived from the people. All government originates with the people, is founded upon their will only, and is instituted solely for the good of the whole. Unfortunately, the will of the majority is often circumvented in Mississippi because the legislature is not representative of a majority of the people. Our neighboring state of Arkansas has an initiative and referendum procedure whereby the people can exercise control when the need arises. Would you favor a constitutional amendment providing for such a procedure in Mississippi?
I would favor a procedure provided for I wouldn't want to call it a referendum vote. I wouldn't want it to mislabel it, because actually there are problems that arise in our state that the legislature is not skilled on. They know nothing about. It doesn't concern them. They're in another field. And there should be a vote, a referendum vote, but this referendum vote should not be by every Tom, Dick, and Harry and every voting citizen in this state that knows nothing about that problem. So problems that arise, certainly the majority should rule, but the majority should rule of those people that it's affecting. For instance, if a problem came up that was affecting the farmers, then the farmers should have the right to vote and the majority should rule. If a problem came up that was affecting the chiropractors should have the right. Or the medical doctors should have a right to determine their own course, or to at least make recommendations to the legislature. And that same thing should apply to labor. If a problem came up, such as your workman's compensation law, then or your right to work bill, which again is a misnamed monstrosity, then that should be determined first by a referendum vote of the people that it is affecting. And as far as this big problem of race is concerned, I'm not so sure about what the colored people of this state, if those having children in schools were given the right to vote, but what they not would not be satisfied and would not, the majority may not want to integrate our public schools. So I think these questions that come up should be decided upon the people that it affects.
The per capita income in Mississippi is the lowest of any state in the nation. The chief contributing factor to this dilemma is the low wages paid to workers who are not covered by the Fair Labor Standards Act. 27 states have already enacted state minimum wage law. Such a law would do much to raise the per capita income and increase purchasing power of the state's workforce. Are you in favor of a state minimum wage law?
I am.
This, of course, would take hold where your federal wage
That's true.
Law A lower percentage of people of voting age are qualified voters in Mississippi than any other state. According to figures recently released by the American Heritage Foundation, only 25% are qualified. Without doubt, the chief deterrent here is a restrictive poll tax law. This tax must be paid 2 years in succession to be eligible to vote in the Democratic primaries. While it may be argued that the poll tax keeps a Negro from voting, the record shows otherwise. When this law was enacted in 1890, there were 120,000 white voters. 2 years later, this figure had dropped to 68,000. Due to the rapid industrial development, many people are moving into our state. Due to these poll tax restrictions, these people are being disfranchised for a 2-year period. Such restrictions are certainly not conducive to industrial development. If elected, would you attempt to alleviate this situation? Specifically, would you advocate an amendment to the Constitution whereby 2 years poll tax could be paid at one time?
First, I don't like the word poll tax. I don't think anybody should have to pay to vote. Now, that word poll tax is just a misnamed word. Now, it might be considered a privilege tax. So consequently, if there would be certain funds necessary to maintain the poll booths and the poll workers, and so I would favor bringing our poll tax law, changing the name of it, and bringing it up to date and calling it a privilege tax. Now, whereas it's just as right that you pay for your clothes that you wear, it's also just as right that somebody has to pay those people that work at the polls. Now that, and those people that have the privilege of voting, it should be called a privilege tax. I would change the name of it. And I would also bring it up to times. Now everything else is raised in cost and since 1890, but not the poll tax. It stayed $2. So I could not, I would evaluate that according to times, according to wages that people earned as compared to when they did then. And I would change the name from poll tax to privilege tax, and I would also recommend it that a person not be, shouldn't have to live in our state for 2 years before he could vote, provided he came from a state where he was a voter and provided he is a good citizen, good moral character.
Tom, I got to leave now.
Okay.
Women constitute approximately a third of the state's workforce. In spite of the fact these women are usually better educated than men, they earn a third less. Many cases, women can be found working side by side with men doing identically the same work, yet being paid much less. Many states have corrected this inequity by enacting laws requiring equal pay to women for work equal to that done by men. Would you favor legislation of this kind?
I certainly would. And that brings us back to these women that's been in the earlier question there. That brings me back thinking of to that topic again. See, I qualified my answer to whether I think a woman should be given subsistence if her husband was killed or lost doing his work. Certainly she, until she was remarried. Now, it's just possible that this lady is working side by side doing the same work and earning, so if she is able and competent, certainly she should not, it should not, again, be upon the company or the insurance to provide her until she, with a certain amount of money until she was married, if she was able to work. But if she is able to work, she certainly should, and can do the work, and is qualified, she should earn the same pay that a man earns.
During the last year, the regular session of the legislature lasted for a period of 5 months. Approximately 3 months was also spent in special session. In addition to being costly to the taxpayers, many members of the legislature have indicated that they have suffered terrific financial loss and can no longer afford the luxury of serving in our lawmaking body. It seems that annual sessions of the legislature with a definite time limit will alleviate this situation. Are you in favor of annual sessions limited to a definite time period?
Yes, I am.
As presiding and chief officer of the Senate, one of your major responsibilities will be the assignment of committee posts to the various senators. The passage or defeat of legislation is often dependent upon the complexion of these committees. If elected, before making committee appointments, would you consult with labor representatives regarding the makeup of committees that will handle labor measures?
I certainly would.
Then, of course, the last question there is that asked you the question if you're interested in either the passage or defeat of any particular legislation not mentioned.
Well, I am. I believe that it's just a disgrace the way our automobile taxes are, tags and license and so forth, and I think that if Alabama and if Louisiana has been able to reduce their tax to $3, I see no reason why Mississippi couldn't reduce their tax to $3. Now, as far as collecting this sales tax, I just don't believe it's right to make anybody work without paying. Those people that run these stores have to collect sales tax, and they don't get one penny for filling out those forms and send it in. And I believe they should be compensated for the work that they do. Yeah, now, is there any other questions you folks would like to ask me? Is there one that I didn't make clear? I could clarify a little bit for you.
Well,
explain a little better so you'll know what I'm talking about.
John, you or Doris have any questions?
I don't have
any questions. Doc, I'd like to say at this point on behalf of our committee here that we appreciate your coming by.
Well, I've enjoyed being here, and also I've enjoyed all your dances for the last 3 years.
We start at the top here and go 1 through 21. I have been reading the questions, and then, of course, you have the opportunity to answer, make any statements you'd like to make, and give the other members of the committee an opportunity to ask you any question they might like, and we will proceed here if you are ready. I might say that this is part of the executive committee of the Mississippi Labor Council. As I stated a minute ago, Mr. Ramsey, due to circumstances beyond his control, hadn't been here. And I'm secretary, treasurer, and director of political education. Mr. Gillespie represents IBEW from Tupelo. Ms. Kelly, there, CWA from here in Jackson. We don't, one of our members had to leave this morning, so. Do you have any legal statements you'd like to make before we start the
procedure? No, I don't know. Don't you think it might take a little bit longer than a few minutes to answer all these questions?
Well, of course it has.
I'm not going to answer them unless I can think them through real good.
Yeah, well, we know that they're fairly new to you, and of course, that's why I pointed out that the others have been under the same circumstances that you are under the same conditions. And I think, as you have probably already noted, that there are things that go beyond the membership of organized labor. Things that pertain to the welfare of other segments of our society.
I'd like to ask this question. What extent do you plan to use these answers that are given from everybody?
Well, what we do is strictly for our record. We, as the executive committee, are the screening committee of the State Labor Council, and we take the answers that you give us. We sit down and evaluate it fairly and impartially. Then we report to our executive board, you see, which is made up of 15 people. Then that executive board in turn considers all candidates from all angles fair and impartially, and then reports to our convention. We do. We make our decisions in a democratic fashion. We, of course, get credit on many occasions, the big bad labor bosses, for dictating to the member.
I love we have personal friends and that.
We don't do that. That's our job, is to get the information, and then it's, of course, given to the people as fairly and impartially as we know how. Certainly, as I made the statement, we don't have any axe to grind with any candidate for public office. A number of them are personal friends that don't figure with us. We forget that when we come into this room, because we are dealing here. We feel that this is a business proposition, and any close personal acquaintances or ties do not figure in this operation here, because if we did, then I'd be the first to say that we had no place in office. So we treat all candidates just alike. We attempt to get their views as the best they can give them, and attempt to explain to them, in some instances, particularly what we're trying to get at here, if they don't thoroughly understand our question, and try to keep it all open and above board. That's the way we operate here. now, of course, course, you can, as I said, I know that you have a schedule here. Your Mr. Sowell called me last night. He wanted to know if you come in a little early. I told him, yes, we'd be happy to. And however, you can take as long as you need on any certain thing. If you don't understand
we're going to sit down a while. We're not in that big a hurry.
We're not rushing you. You know what I mean? You know your schedule. That's what we're here for.
I've got about an hour and a half before 3 o'clock. Mm-hmm. That's the main thing. I don't want to try to go to Bay Springs any sooner than that.
One of your opponents drove up from Law here yesterday morning, an hour and a half. I think he was a little shook up.
Ate dinner.
I think he was a little shook up after he got thinking about it.
Turn that gadget off just a minute. Let me ask some questions. It was in May of 1958, the day after I was reelected. As you well know or did know, they had a strike at Johns Manville planting matches. We worked with those fellows and knew a lot of them, and they wouldn't accept anyone else as a mediator, so to speak. As a result of it, after about 72 hours of a steady grind, it was finally settled. The blame as can be placed any way it wants to as far as the cause of it was concerned, but I think the boys hadn't married or I wouldn't have fooled with it. And I have a letter from the officials and the members of the unions in Natchez, and also a letter which I wanted to have with me today, but they in Natchez and I'm here. And from the fellow mediator and the union saying that without the assistance, the thing could have never been settled, which I point that up as an example of that we can get along.
It's true.
Do, and I wanted to preface the whole thing with that. Now, as far as a lot of these questions, frankly, I'm not a slow thinker, but I'm not going to answer them and then have to back up on something, because if I tell you something, that's the way I'm going to be. And there's no point in. And frankly, I don't know enough about some of the. I don't know near as much about it as you do. And I think there are improvements that definitely need to be made. And I am certainly not opposed to the local and the state level union. I oppose a national man very much.
Well, of course.
I resent any outside interference into our affairs. I think we can handle it in Mississippi much better ourselves than we can for somebody else.
Well, actually, here, now, as far as we are concerned, maybe I better say this, that certainly we are, we represent the labor movement in Mississippi. We are elected by secret ballot.
That's what I know, but I want to put that in there.
In Mississippi, see.
But in Natchez, I don't think that they can run the situation any better than it is. At times they have problems, but it's strictly on a local situation, and those boys are, they're respected by the community. That's what I know about it. I mean, that's the thing. What I know is what I better talk about.
With reference to the Department of Labor, then you, what you have said is that you are not in a position to say whether you would.
I would
be
say
for
that,
or against.
That I would have to make a statement that, frankly, if it would improve the situation, that I see nothing wrong with it. But as far as saying I'm for it or against it, I would be doing us both an injustice, and I'm not hedging.
Well, as I pointed out, there are numbers of things, and this is just one instance that we have, that we are pointing out. The reason we bring this up is because, as I said, of some views of some of the candidates for office, not only this year, but 4 years ago, for that matter, that the Department of Labor was just strictly another way of advancing organized labor. Well, certainly we very vigorously disagree with this view, because as we see it, it goes far beyond the bounds of organized labor. And a thing like this, you see, the only thing there is in this state is a policy of the state health department here, and they have two men that covers this entire state. And you know, with as much industry as we got, conditions are bound to be bad, depending on that type of operation. Of course, Department of Labor would administer, that is, it would depend too on the bill, the type, the way the law was drawn up. But the usual Department of Labor would administer your Employment Security Act, your workman's compensation, your mediation, conciliation service, compile all kinds of data, statistics that, as I said, would be vital to the employer as well as the employee. So I just want to point out those things there, that our ideas of a Department of Labor certainly is.
Well, I don't blame y'all a bit in the world for them. Mm-hmm.
Actually, it's the only state in the 50, see?
I can see your point completely, but as I said, I would be done us both an injustice if I would say I was for it, because frankly, if it can work, I see nothing wrong with it.
Yeah.
But I think that's as far as we better go on that.
We feel it. State of Mississippi, the officials of the state of Mississippi should think as much of the working people as the state as they think of the fish and game.
See, you got your game and fish commission.
Definitely have merit in what you're saying.
And actually, the working people have suffered far. And again, I'm speaking about working people, period. Non-union, union alike. And two, as I point out, the only state in the 50 that don't have such a department. Okay, we'll move on down here. Regard to number two, of course, we realize that the apportionment has helped solve this problem. And certainly we are grateful, as you probably know, we actively supported the reapportionment.
Sure it is.
And we are grateful for that. However, the thing we are getting at here is, will we continue trying, you know what I mean, to more strictly apportion the thing according to the population?
I think this reapportionment here was very fine, and it will be a continuing process to get it more equal.
In other words, you would be far continuing the fight for a true reapportionment.
Now, you got a shot at it again in 1970. That's the next time you'll have it.
That's right. That's true.
You won't have it before then.
Of course, that's a lot sooner. That is better than what we've done for 73 years.
Yeah, 73 years. It was needed. There's no question.
Right. Absolutely. Now, number three. Of course, this is something that's very close to us, because it means so much to the injured worker. We refer here to the workman's compensation, which was adopted in 1949, and the crippling amendments in 1960, of course. This is something that we've been concerned with since the 1960 session. The legislature, as I don't know how familiar with it you are, this is a very deep and detailed subject. Certainly, I'm not a lawyer, and there's a lot that I don't know about it, but generally, as you probably know, the language of this act was so changed that it is harder, more difficult than ever before for that injured worker to connect the injury with the occupation, and also to complete his file in that much as he gets the money. You know what I mean? Now it's almost impossible for a worker it's hurt on the job, the injury that's job connected, it's almost impossible for that worker to get anything without getting an attorney and going to court. You'll notice here down in E under that, make employer insurance carrier liable for attorney fees when worker has to resort to courts for relief. Now, there is workers today, as a result of the 1960 amendment, that actually draw, in some cases, as little as $3 a week. The language was so changed until the courts that used to interpret it fair and impartially, now the way the thing is written now, you find the courts in most of the case siding with the, well, against the worker. That's what it
amounts
to.
Well, there been some abuses of the law, though, prior to 1960.
Well, not as far as we are concerned. Because
I know a man that grew a good bit in Natchez that was more entitled to it than I was. I mean, that was personal knowledge of the situation. Mm-hmm. Of course, he got a settlement on it, which mm-hmm. I feel like if a person has been hurt on the job, he definitely should be compensated yeah. for it.
But well, of course, I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't be one to deny the fact that it had not been abused at some time. But I would say generally.
Well, I think the man's entitled to compensation if he's hurt on the job.
Mm-hmm.
And that law has been thousands and thousands of words mm-hmm. written on it, and I'm not a lawyer either.
Yeah. I know that some of the problems that we've had, particularly in the last 3 years, we've got people that are suffering, that was hurt on the job, and they have been told that this is not job connected. See, and there are people that chances are will never be able to work to any extent, do real labor anymore.
I know two or three have been hurt that should be compensated and haven't mm-hmm. been, which is mm-hmm. it's abused maybe
yeah.
both ways.
Yeah.
But I feel that a person, in answer to the whole question, I would say that I feel a person is entitled to compensation if he's injured on the job.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know any other way to answer.
Of course, you'll note here, D, we mentioned allow worker freedom of choice of doctor. Now, we were...
As long as he's recognized by the medical association, I don't see what makes any difference.
Well, you see the way the thing is now. He first must go to the employer's doctor. Then he has a right. If for some reason or other he don't agree or has some reason to think that the diagnosis of the company doctor is not proper, then if he goes to his own doctor, then what happens? That worker winds up in a crossfire of medical battle there, you see, between the two doctors. One will say this is true, and the other say no, it's this is the trouble. So actually you get in a conflict there, which only means a burden, it amounts to a burden on the worker, and for months and months there's nothing settled, see. Some people are of the opinion that the worker can go to their own doctor first, but they cannot, the way the law is now.
I had a little disagreement with doctors. I bumped into the back end of a car one day going about 5 miles an hour. One doctor said there wasn't anything wrong with the person. Another one said it was. They collected $3,000, though. Didn't do any damage whatsoever to the car.
Yeah.
And this woman wasn't even driving. Not a thing in the world, but insurance company had to pay her. So I agree with you. I think the doctors will make...
Yeah, you get in a tough situation now when you get two of them disagreeing. I suppose you've already read number four there. What it amounts to is that we are advocating here that the state should guarantee a loan, college education, to qualified. You notice we put the word qualified high school
graduate. I'm all for that one, 100%.
That's
But that's one of the very strong points I have.
The future of the state.
You know,
depends on the education of the city.
Keeping our talent here in the state.
Right, that's right, and that's one of the things. That the big cry is that opportunities in the state. Well, we all know that people hadn't had the opportunities they need, and of course hadn't had the education. Then we come to another subject that of course is always of concern to us, unemployment compensation. And we raised four questions there. Would you be for raising the maximum weekly benefits above $30? And extend the maximum period of duration beyond 26 weeks.
I have a business in Natchez. You may know that. We have an insurance program in existence down there. And I'll tell you what I do. the hospitalization and working compensation, I pay the whole, it's cost me $14 per individual per month. They have to pay nothing, but I pay it all for all every employee. It works 12, 13 of them that work for me in my business. And that's the way I feel about the situation. Now, as far as raising the benefits on it, now, if a man is hurt, he cannot live on $30 a week.
No, that's true.
But I have gone one step further. When we have had people out of work in my business for as much as 3 months, one man 4 months, and I paid him his full salary the whole time.
Well, this is unusual.
But I don't think some of them are entitled to $30 a week, to be honest with you, and I think some of them are entitled to more than $30 a week. But if a man is hurt for a long period of time and is actually connected with his employment, I think he should be taken care of.
Well, of course, the thing that this number five down here is, of course, to compensate the person when they're out of work for any reason, you know, wouldn't necessarily.
I've seen some of this. I mean, I fired a man for stealing one time, and he went down and signed up for the unemployment compensation. I filled it out just exactly the reason he had been dismissed. And he didn't get it, as far as I know. And,
well, naturally, he wouldn't have fought an offense of that kind. There's one thing. This D here, remove unfair disqualification provisions of present law.
Do you understand this law? I mean,
well, fairly well.
I've been paying this unemployment compensation insurance for 13 and a half years, and frankly, I don't understand it.
Well,
I've studied it. I know my rate goes up.
Yeah.
It's 2.8 right now.
It's quite a complicated thing. There are very few people except those people that work in it, and I doubt if, I dare say that to some of these people out here at the Employment Security Commission that are not familiar with all facets of the thing.
I've seen some people that certainly should be getting unemployment compensation. Mm-hmm. They're not getting it.
Yeah.
I've seen others riding it.
Yeah.
And they're getting it. If you know the answer, tell me, because I don't know it.
Well, of course, a lot of that lies within the administration of the thing, between the person that it's intended to help and the legislature. You see, the administration of the thing.
I've been paying it for, as I said, for 13 and a half years, and never been one person that has drawn any of it.
Is that right? Evidently your employment is pretty
well,
studied.
That was the only one.
Is that right?
But it's still every quarter.
That's true.
And it runs up into money after a while.
That's right. Of course, where you your employment evidently is rather studied for the employees
it's
you
wholesale
have.
Tobacco
you've got,
and specialty business.
Yeah. You've got other businesses, that there's always somebody out of a job, see? But the thing that we've had more trouble with lately, that we are concerned about more than anything else here, is this D, remove unfair disqualification provisions of the present law. Now, what we refer to there is the word misconduct that's in the contents of this law. Now, this word misconduct has been taken. In other words, it's not specifically used. Misconduct has been construed to mean almost anything. I'll give you an illustration, a very simple one that I think points out what we are concerned about. I don't know what you know about the garment industry, but you know we've got an awful lot of garment plants in Mississippi. In every fork of the road is a garment plant. we'll take a And of course, I'm speaking about a non-union plant now, primarily. We'll take a garment plant. You know, all garment manufacturing is set up on incentive. You know, you do so much work, you get so much piecework, basically. We'll take a plant where you've got only 15 or 20% of the total number of employees that are making their quota. It's known as a quota. And it's been going on this way some time. All of a sudden, the company decides that they're going to clean house. They're going to hire new employees. Well, they discharge these people. And their reason, of course, as you stated a while ago, you're supposed to give a reason. See, you're supposed to notify the employment office of the reason of discharge. Well, they put on the reason there, the reason for discharge is misconduct. Nothing wrong with the conduct, they couldn't make the quota. Well, now this is the thing we're running into, see. The word misconduct, of course, what it would take to alleviate this would be an amendment to the act itself.
Anything they put down, I feel like they ought to be able to prove it.
Well, that's
don't
true.
Put it down,
that's,
which would take care of that situation.
Yeah, that's true, but it is
misconduct. It's a multitude of sin.
That's right. That's right. So that's one of the problems. Mississippi's tax structure leaves much to be desired. Most of the state's revenue derived from the sales tax or other consumer tax, which means that the bulk of the tax burden is being carried by those least able to pay. According to reliable estimates, the state will need $450 million in new revenue to balance its 64-66 budget. Assuming that you're in favor of a balanced budget, how do you propose to raise this needed revenue?
Well, I'll give you an illustration to get my point on this. I was mayor of Natchez for two terms. We went in with a general millage of 21 mills. We eliminated $180,000 worth of unnecessary expenditures in the city budget, and we added about $180,000 to $190,000 worth of additional services. And when I went out of office, it was 21 and a half mills. It was 21 mills when I went out. It was a half a mill less. We eliminated a lot of the unnecessary items, and the taxes were actually decreased over a six-year period of time. I think if it actually takes the money to run the state over what they will receive, then we must have new taxes, but nobody can convince me that it will take more than what we'll raise.
Mm-hmm.
So I am definitely not for a tax increase at all,
mm-hmm.
unless it is absolutely necessary, and I don't think it's necessary. I think we can cut the garment to fit the cloth.
Well, of course, there's a lot of discussion pro and con.
I don't think it's
going to
be $40 or $50 million either. I don't think it's going to be that much.
Well, I don't know. It might not.
According to the study that I have made of the state's budget, I mean, over the last year or two, and it may be, but I seriously doubt if it'll be $40 to $50 million. But I am definitely not for putting an additional tax on. I think that before anything like that is done, I'm a hard-headed mule. They've got to show me where it's necessary, and I don't think they can.
But you are in favor of a balanced budget.
I am definitely in favor of a balanced budget. And if part of my problem is that deficit financing is wrong. It places a burden on future generations that they should not be asked to bear. I'll tell you what I do. I'll just read it to you. I believe in economic progress without deficit financing. Progress is an issue because the destiny of our state and welfare of our people depend on it. We have not scratched the surface in recognizing our economic potential and wealth. You can put that in your quote. That'll sum up probably questions that we don't answer. But
go ahead.
I am for a balanced budget, and I think it can definitely be balanced.
Okay. To go a little further here along those lines, down in the A, B, C, B, F, G there, for instance, sales tax, should there be a necessity to secure additional revenue, would you be in favor of increasing the sales tax?
We tried to put on an extra half cent in Natchez. We have a half a cent. And regardless of what you say or I say or anything else, but we have a large segment of population in Mississippi. It pays no tax but the sales tax. And you know very well what I'm talking about. In Natchez, the 45% of the population pays about 13 or 14% of the taxes. Before we, it was defeated, by the way, but before we proposed this thing, I called Robert Fly. You know Robert. Mm-hmm. Robert's yep. a very good friend of mine. He was on the advisory committee that I appointed. I appointed him on it, and I appointed him on two or three other things. And we asked him, and I went out and talked to the Central Labor Council in Natchez, which I don't mind associating with them. I mean, they're friends of mine. But at the same time, we got their endorsement of this extra 0.5% before we along with some of the others, and it was still defeated as far as that goes. I don't believe in putting tax on anybody, but I think that every man should pay his fair share of the tax.
All right, next thing, we're dealing with a prevailing wage law here, particularly in the building construction trade. During recent years, a number of construction projects financed by local and state funds have been manned with out-of-state workmen. Many of these projects were financed with bond issues supported by local citizenry who thought that workers from within the state would benefit by the new jobs provided. The only effective means to deal with a problem of this kind is to enact a state prevailing wage law. If elected, would you support such an act?
All of these things I'm going to have to give you illustrations look like. That's, but I have asked, when I was again mayor down there, I've asked the managers of each of those plants in Natchez to hire people from Mississippi. I believe that's the way it starts off. You're out of state working.
Yeah.
And I still think that if the tax exemptions are going to be given to industry, then the people within the state should be the ones that benefit from it, not people outside the state. Now we have a very, I don't know, not bad situation, but when you get down our way, you've got too many people that don't live in Mississippi that work in Mississippi. And I know it's that way in other sections, work in others. I don't know what you can answer that with.
Mr. Watkins, what we have in mind here is in the construction industry.
I'm in the construction business too.
Yeah. Where your non-union contractors receive a contract within the state of Mississippi. They in turn can bring their employees that they have regularly hired with them into the state of Mississippi to perform this work at a lower wage rate than is a prevailing wage rate within that
area. I have always taken the position that the people should pay the prevailing scale. If that answers that question, I don't know whether it does or not.
Well, actually, what we've done, yeah, we've asked if you would be in favor of such an act, making this into law, establishing a prevailing wage.
Could you do it?
Yeah, it could be done. You see what this does, Mr. Watkins, this takes up a state law of this nature, would take up where the federal Davis-Bacon prevailing wage law ends. You understand? If it was federal money, you noticed, yeah, we said state or local funds. See, well, the Davis-Bacon prevailing wage law would not reach this far, see. And we are referring here to legislation that would take up where that law leaves off, you see, and provide a state prevailing wage.
I don't know whether I'd be in favor of that or not. I definitely think that they should pay the prevailing scale, but I don't know about, I reckon the law would be the only way you could. Yeah.
Well, as we point out, that would be the only way you could, the only way you couldn't enforce anything else. You couldn't have an agreement because agreements just don't have that kind of teeth in them, see. next question, of course, as you've already noted, probably deals with the elections. We point out the fact here that government can be best protected by a greater participation of the electorate, and it has been proven in some of the other states. A matter of fact, Texas is one that comes to mind at the moment, who changed their election days from Tuesday to Saturdays because As you would probably agree, in Mississippi, Saturday is usually referred to as a non-work day on public jobs. Now, we know that such as Armstrong and Natchez, these places run around the clock. There's no particular day, no particular week. But ordinarily, under ordinary circumstances, Saturday is an off day, you know what I mean. Now, with reference to, and you'll notice we note here that several states have enacted laws whereby the employers must allow time off to vote. Now, of course, we are referring now largely to the non-union plants, because in our contracts, in most of our union contracts, and in those where we don't have it in writing, we have a mutual agreement that if an employee cannot work their regular schedule and get to their voting precinct before the polls close, then they will be allowed half a day or whatever might be necessary for them to go vote. Now, of course, in your non-union plants, the individual employee is, it's up to himself, between him and the employer. Well, some employers certainly will, others won't. So actually, what's being done there, those people are not allowed their privilege to vote. This is the thing we are concerned with. And as I said, Texas moved their election from Tuesday to Saturday. In other words, what we are after here is trying to come up with something that would ensure our people, the working people, an opportunity to go to the polls and vote.
If a man's job would prevent him from voting, I certainly think he should be given the time off to go vote. I think that really where we all fall down is too few take an interest in it.
That's right. You're right. I agree. I
don't think a man's job should be so that it would prevent him from voting. Mm-hmm. If it takes time off from his job to vote, he should be allowed the time off.
You would then, I take it, you'd be willing to consider the possibility of changing the day of election.
If it would increase it, I'd be ready to change it. It's been bad of an eye. Mm-hmm. If Saturday would bring out more votes, I'd be in favor of it. Mm-hmm. Of course, I started to say Sunday, but I better not say that.
You wouldn't be the only one that's mentioned that, by the way.
Well, I think it should be whatever it takes to get more people out is what we should do.
Number nine, one of the major needs of Mississippi workers is protection against the loss of wages incurred by non-occupational injury or illness. Prohibitive high cost of medical and hospital care makes this a serious problem. Workman's compensation insurance recognizes the need of insurance for workmen on the job. It would therefore appear that a temporary disability insurance law is the answer to this problem. Would you support legislation of this nature?
On what participation from the employee and the employer?
Well, what we are referring to here, as is stated here, this would affect the person sick from natural causes, everything other than occupational, which works.
Yeah, I understand that, but I mean, who would pay for it?
Well, now, we do have some, referring again to the union plans, we have some arrangements here, and Mr. Gillespie there is in better position than I am, because they have just entered into an agreement with their employer up there for an insurance of this type. John, you might discuss
Well, this
discuss
is
that
a law
situation.
Could be written to where it could all be borne by the company. Of course, that's the way we'd love to see it.
I will be honest about it.
But it can be handled both ways, and is handled both ways now, even in union contracts. The law could be written to where it could be worked out mutually between the management and the employees. I know a number of them are paid percentage-wise, where the employee pays 40, the company 60, or maybe they split it half and half. We are fortunate, I reckon, the company that I do business with, they pay it all. Actually, no matter who pays it, it reflects back within your wage structure. Actually, the employee ends up paying it.
Well, it's really not that's considered a fringe benefit after all.
It is a fringe benefit, yes, but...
Looking at it on the surface.
On the surface. But when you get down into it, the employee pays it because it's considered as so many cents per hour.
And too, looking at it from anybody's point of view, it comes cheaper by group. You know what I mean?
Yeah, than it does individually. I've just completed negotiating one. I think it's one of the best ones that I've seen lately.
Well, you didn't have a law to do that with, though, did you?
I had a union contract.
Well, you don't need a law, then.
No, this is for the non-union.
Yeah, this is
for the
straight. We're thinking more about the non-union. This is not see. You see what we've done. Actually, people would only stop and think a few minutes. We have done the unorganized worker a great service.
More good than you have yourself.
Well,
you know, I'm an ultra-conservative in government. And I'm a firm believer in Jefferson's principle that the government that governs least is the government that governs best. And we have got, well, I think some man said the other day, 30 million laws on the statute books in the United States to enforce the Ten Commandments, which is an awful lot of laws. And we've got laws on top of laws that are really of no use whatsoever. And if the whole thing could probably be reorganized and eliminate a lot of the ones that we have and bring it up to a better standard, and I'd be for it. But I'm the incentive that people should have, a lot of it's gone, because we get right back on it. When a man makes money, the federal government takes a lot of it away from him. Right, when he punches the clock, he knows he's going to be here today and he's going to be here tomorrow and the next day. I don't think there should be any abuses whatsoever to the working man. And Lord, they're good supporters of mine down there. I know them. And we have never done anything against them. And we have done things for them. And I've been newspaper full page when I was running for mayor. It was hand-picked man of the AFL-CIO out of Washington. Well, I didn't know anything about it. I didn't know I was picked by anybody. But that's what the National Democrat had in it in the second primary the first time I was elected.
That sounded like the Chief Blue Journal.
It was an advertised full page. Well, frankly, I didn't. It didn't matter particularly, but it did. It cost us some votes. But we beat the Dickens out of it when it was all over with. And I think that it aroused enough people whereby they got out and did what they're supposed to do. But see, the whole thing is so easily misunderstood. And I am not for a law unless that law is absolutely necessary. Now, if the employee and employer can work it out, then I'm not for a law.
Well, we can work it out where we have a union contract.
Yeah, that's true.
But I'm not for a law whereby the two people, I don't like to tell you what you've got to do. I want you to do it on your own initiative and on your own free will.
Of course, the thing we're concerned with here is the fact that just what you said will not happen in the places
the
where you don't
thing,
have a union.
I don't
see.
Like to point a finger at nothing. It's just like you are, and you would resent if I told you you had to do something, wouldn't you?
Yes, sir. Always have.
I always have. And I don't like anybody to tell me what I'm supposed to do. And I don't, if a law is absolutely necessary in order to eliminate a lot of bad things, then I think the law should be passed. But I first think that it ought to be worked out between the two groups.
Okay, we are on school teachers' pay here now. Top flight teachers are absolutely necessary for our children to receive the best in education. We have no right to expect skilled and dedicated teachers to remain in our schools unless we're willing to pay them a living wage. In spite of the fact that our teachers received some recognition by the last legislature, their salaries are still far below the average paid by most other southern states. Pitifully low compared with the national average. Are you in favor of increasing teachers' pay up to the average for southern states?
I'm in favor of giving the teachers every dime we can give them. I'm also in favor, I mean, not of a third factor, but something other than a certificate and a degree in paying a teacher. I mean, what it would take, you know, would let the Education Association itself come up with it. But I don't think that a person, because they have been teaching 30 years, and this one's been teaching 30 years, this one has a BA degree, and this one has a BA degree, if this one is 10 times better teacher, then this one ought to make more money than that one. You agree there? You agree
in other words, what you're saying is they should be paid according to ability to get the job done?
That's exactly the way the labor union itself believes. I mean, that's their whole theory. If a man's entitled to it, he should get more.
Well, we say the seniority with ability.
Right. Well, that's exactly what I say here. I mean, I'm not getting into a controversy with them on it.
But you say that they all need...
We have a system in Natchez that has worked most successfully. And it is the third factor, which frankly I don't think the third factor is enough. I think there ought to be other things in there that would determine whether a person was qualified. But they have had it in operation there for about 10 years, and it's worked out very well. But I think ability with the experience and with the degree should determine it. But I am for paying the teachers more money if they, a lot of them, well, actually most of them are entitled more than what they get.
The labor laws of Mississippi fail to provide adequate protection for children employed in intrastate commerce. In view of the fact that Mississippi's economy is moving from agrarian to industrial, it is imperative that our child labor laws be updated. Are you in favor of improving?
I'm in favor of improving any laws that pertain to the children.
State employee has the right job security as does any other worker, provided he or she is competent and efficiently fulfills job requirements. Stability and efficiency of our government demands that legislation be enacted whereby a person would not have to guess right in a governor's election to retain employment. Discharge a state employee would create a vacancy to be filled by a supporter of the winner's moral and wrong and cost to the taxpayer. Are you in favor of a civil service law to cover all state employees except those that are elected or otherwise appointed under specific requirements of law?
It took me 5 years in Natchez to get a merit system in operation.
Is that right?
So they wouldn't have to worry about whether they guess right along, just keep their mouth shut in a local election. So I don't think they ought to have to be politically afraid of this job.
Mississippi is one of the three remaining states in the nation that still refuses to allow women to sit on juries. This prohibition is unworthy of the enlightened people of our state. The House of Representatives passed a jury bill during the 1962 session of the legislature, only to see it die in committee when it got to the Senate. What is your position on that?
Now, one person you had up here said they ought to have them on the jury. I know that. And there's one other person in this room that would say the same thing. What do y'all ask such pointed questions like that for?
Well, actually, we are very much interested in it. This shouldn't be controversial. I mean, it's just.
Well, I can't
nobody,
see.
I can't see
the difference in a woman sitting on a jury than one voting.
I'll tell
and
you.
And I certainly think they ought to vote.
Well, I tell you that we had one kind.
I like
here.
That answer, lady.
I tell you, one answer we had here was that
number one,
they had no business working. Of course, we're going to come to this place. But said the woman's place was at home. But says if they're going to be out there, says give them all the opportunities the rest of it. I'll tell you what, the one candidate for governor said 4 years ago, we were sitting in this room talking. This came up as jury duty, and of course, we didn't even have time to emphasize the fact that we were certainly aware that the county would have to provide certainly better facilities and jury rooms, and they got locked up.
He
said, I'm going to send you something now. He says, I'm not going to stand for these women to be locked up in these jury rooms at night with these men.
Did he have his constitution in one hand and the Bible in the other?
Be ashamed talking about that man right there. Really, that throws me for a loop. I tell you,
have you ever heard that man make a speech?
No.
You ought to hear. He's a clown.
But you know, after about an hour here, he asked us if we wasn't tax experts. We talked with him an hour before he ever realized who he was talking to here. I'll never forget his answer on the women jury thing.
A woman would give a man a better chance on that jury than all men would. They soft-hearted.
Oh, man. It's true that the last legislature increased maximum assistance to the aged and totally disabled from $40 to $50. It's also true that the same legislature failed to appropriate necessary finances for this assistance. This failure means that few of these people are receiving over $40 per month at the time. If elected, what would you propose to do?
Would you incorporate that statement where it says responsibility is the answer to that question, lady, in that folder? Mm-hmm. Right here. I feel like it. The state has a definite responsibility to assist in the care of the indigent. However, I believe equally as strong that every able-bodied man should be required to earn his own subsistence. That answers that completely.
Of course, number 15 is something that new to most people over here. Well, a lot of people are familiar with it in other states, but we refer to Arkansas here, and a democracy of supreme power to govern is contained by the people. Mississippi's Constitution agrees with this concept, for Article 3, Section 5 reads as follows. All political power is vested in and derived from the people. All government originates with the people, is founded upon their will only, and instituted solely for the good of the whole. Unfortunately, the will of the majority is often circumvented in Mississippi because the legislature is not representative of a majority of the people. Our neighboring state of Arkansas has an initiative referendum procedure whereby the people can exercise control when the need arises. Would you favor a constitutional amendment providing for such a procedure in Mississippi?
Only in very urgent cases I wouldn't favor a blanket deal like that. People, after a man goes around and gets elected, it's their mistake, it's not the man's mistake. They
I'm agreeing with you, Mr. People of Mississippi have made some awful blunders in electing people to public office. I've often wondered if the whole state wasn't intoxicated on the case.
People made a terrible mistake in 1960 in electing a man president, too. Mississippi didn't make that mistake.
Well, of course, Mississippi's votes was thrown away. They went down in a hole somewhere where we'll never know where they went. To me, it seems like that's what happened to them.
But you don't have anybody to blame on what kind of officials the state elect but the people themselves.
That's true.
They are in the men that belong to labor unions in the city of Natchez, Mississippi. There are at least 1,500 of them that don't vote.
Your fault and all of you boys' fault. But I will say this, though. I can't give you any specific figure, but I'll say this. We got a lot more qualified voters than we had in 1959.
Well, now, I imagine you have.
We're going down more.
Nobody knows. You've got in the state where you have 450,000 people that are qualified to vote. Mm-hmm. You should have 700 to 750,000, and that doesn't include the colored population either.
True. That's right.
But it's everybody's fault.
But we have a program, you see, an active program in the labor movement, and we have active card files in every central labor union area. There's 14 in Mississippi, and we are getting our people qualified. It's a slow process, but we're getting everybody in the state to be able to vote, and that's what
we need all the way around.
Right.
Get them qualified.
The per capita income in Mississippi is the lowest of any state in the nation. The chief contributing factor to this dilemma is the low wages paid to workers who are not covered by the Fair Labor Standards Act. 27 states have already enacted state minimum wage laws. Such a law would do much to raise per capita income and increase purchasing power of the state's workforce. Are you in favor of a state minimum wage law?
Not until they can show me where it's absolutely necessary. Like I was saying a while ago, I feel like that laws a lot of times are passed and they if you could balance it out, we'd have something.
Well, actually, here's the situation.
I know what you're talking about. You're talking about these $15 a week clerks
right.
in stores and no dollar a week waitresses and
that's
cafes,
right.
depending
Absolutely.
On the tips and
so you see,
everything
the national
else.
Law does not cover them, and therefore there's no these people. Again, we are working here for the unorganized.
Sure. You're doing more on this sheet of paper than unorganized. You ought to organize. They better put you in their employment.
Hey, they're going to recognize that some of these days. A lower percentage of people of voting age are qualified voters in Mississippi than any other state. See, you're just talking about this a minute ago. According to figures recently released from American Heritage Foundation, only 25% are qualified. Without doubt, the chief deterrent here is restrictive poll tax laws. This tax must be paid 2 years in succession to be eligible to vote in Democratic primaries. While it may be argued that the poll tax keeps a Negro from voting, the record shows otherwise. When this law was enacted in 1890, there were 120,000 white voters. 2 years later, this figure dropped to 68,000. Due to the rapid industrial development, many people are moving into our state. Due to these poll tax restrictions, these people are being disfranchised for a 2-year period. Such restrictions are certainly not conducive to industrial development. If elected, would you attempt to alleviate this situation? Specifically, would you advocate an amendment of the Constitution whereby 2 years poll tax could be paid at one time?
Well, I have never seen where 2 years, or if a man's going to live in the state 1 year, he's just as qualified to vote as if he'd live at 2 years. I thought you were going to get down to eliminating the poll tax. You should have
gone back on this thing
here where you showed 120,000 and 68,000. You should have gotten the figures for 1894, which was an election year.
Mm-hmm.
On your odd years, they're always lower.
Mm-hmm.
In 1961 in Mississippi, you had a lot of drops in poll tax, but
yep.
they caught it up the next 2 years. I don't see where they should be required to wait the full 2 years. I think 1 year would suffice.
Yeah, we recognize the usefulness of the poll tax money.
When it goes to the school.
That's right. And
otherwise we wouldn't have an argument on that,
that's
really.
That's right. That's right. We're just trying to work out something here by which the person could go pay that back here. And
here we come with another woman question.
Yeah. this is the one I...
I'm for the women. Don't miss it. I'll quote that period.
You think the women should stay at home?
No, I don't.
This is the question now where I got the answer that the women should be at home in the first place,
yeah.
but if they're coming out to work, then pay them. This is a problem, of course, that we certainly interested in. Now, we even have I won't read this, I'm sure you've already read it. We even have this problem, I'll say, in the organized locals. In negotiations...
You don't get them the same wage either, do you?
Well, most of the time now. But we are getting them the same wage because we won't come out for anything less if they perform the job, see. As I started to say, we do have this problem. We have quite a heated argument on occasions. Because we are insisting that Susie gets the same thing as Johnny gets over here because she is doing the same thing he's doing. But as I said a minute ago, they want to buck a little on this, but we finally come up with it. But there again, we're working for the unorganized people, see. That if that girl, we say if that girl is doing that job, then she's entitled to that pay. Because that same that she may be a widow woman with a house full of children. Well, certainly she's entitled to the pay.
All the women
she's
have to work.
The duty.
No question about it. I wish my wife worked and maybe I could stay at home. No, I don't think there should be very much discrimination along those lines. As long as, and it's almost gotten to the point where man and wife have to work in order to live.
Yeah, that's right. And they do most of the bossing, so why
they do all the confounded bossing. No question about that. And they take both checks, so what they hollering about?
More money.
More money, money, money. I'm in favor of an annual legislative session with a limit of 60 days.
All right.
That answers that one.
Well, we were quite disturbed, naturally, because of this last year's circus we had over here.
Which one?
This last 1962, the 8 months. The 8 month circus, yeah. I was connecting them all together, see, that 8 month circus we had. Did you know that that has brought about decisions by many capable members of the legislature not to seek re-election because lawyers, their law practice got shot on them. Other businessmen, their business went to the dogs. And as a result, we're losing a lot of quite capable members of the legislature. And of course, that other question, that 20, is one that...
I have always discussed matters pertaining to the people that it would affect.
We are not. I think some of them maybe were a little misconstrued a little. We, as we told somebody in a joking way, we certainly don't want any... wouldn't want to try to tell the lieutenant governor who to put on the committee. We would like to have the opportunity
be
to
advise
right with
it. Except to discuss it. I mean, regardless of what committee it would be, anybody that was interested in that particular phase of government certainly should be consulted, whether it was labor or management or the different committees involved in the Senate.
Well, of course, you supposedly already read the other statement there. If there's anything that you were interested in, that you'd like to mention to us, or any other thing you'd like to say, well, certainly you'd feel free to do that.
There's a lot of things that I would like to mention, but I think we'd better just hit the base springs.
Yeah. Talk to them in Jasper County.
Yeah, I've got a lot of relatives down there.